Well, hey, y'all. Hey, welcome everyone to Saki Speakeasy Podcast. I'm your host, Saki Speaks. Thanks for giving me a slice of your most precious commodity, your time. I truly appreciate you. Let me pull this thing to me a little more, child. That's what I told him. Anyway, I'm so crazy. Anyway, y'all do me a favor and show my moderator, Love Jones, a little love, please, and thank you. And also make sure that you like the video on your way in the door. Drop down in the chat box and say, hey, girl, hey. And if you haven't already, please consider subscribing to the channel, making sure that you click that notification bell and select all so you don't miss out on a single chapter. All right. Now, with all of that being said, welcome to all of my brand new sippers and speakers. I appreciate you subscribing, and I hope that you find a reason to stick around. And welcome back to my returning sippers and speakers, as well as those of you catching this on the replay. Thanks for coming back one more again to love up on your girl, because y'all know I love how y'all love on me. All right, let's see who's here. I see we got some folks in the, as my sister say, in the booches. Not the booches, but anyway, child. First sipper and speaker through the door is Demo. Hey, girl. Hey, welcome. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. And of course, my annoyingly wonderful little sister and moderator extraordinaire, Love Jones, is in the building. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here as well. So I was actually supposed to come at 5:30, but I wanted to make sure that we go ahead on and wrap this one up. I didn't even bother to look, child. Perhaps I could have saved myself some time if I had actually looked, but I didn't look to see exactly how much time was left in the book. I know how many chapters are left, but time-wise, I'm a little uncertain with that, but whatever. I just figured the earlier I get out here, the faster we'll get finished, because I definitely want to finish this one today, so I'm going to shut the fuck up and get the timestamp and get rolling, because, yeah, that's the only way we're going to get through this, because there's two other books left. So that's why I'm trying to hurry up. So we just letting the timer count down. I hope everybody had a wonderful weekend, child. I hope y'all are having a great day today. You know, that's it, child. Just hope y'all are in sound mind and body and excellent spirits, okay? That's basically what I want for each and every one of you. How about that? Okay, so let's get to getting on down the road. Chapter 16, Pleasure Strong. My horses, Chance and Lucky, were out back getting cleaned, and I was out there with them. I'd been using this company for a while, and I trusted them with Chance and Lucky, but I would still come out there with them just to watch and take notes, because sometimes I clean the horses myself. I'd had a lot of heavy shit going on in my life lately, so I hadn't been able to come out there and freely ride my horses, but I did make it my business to come out there to check on them and love on them from time to time. It was Saturday evening, and of course, my man wasn't home. Once he told me about the shit show that happened the other day in one of his traps with Petey and the other guys, I already knew Corporate would be coming home later than usual or just gone more, because now he had to find a new trap location. Those stupid-ass niggas were just giving my husband more and more reasons to lack trust. I had picked up on the change in Corporate. Hell, I was his wife, so it would have been a shame on me if I didn't pick up on those small changes. For example, yesterday morning, I woke up earlier than usual, so I was able to join him in the gym downstairs for a workout. Most times when I went for my workout in the morning, I would come down when my husband was wrapping up. Yesterday morning, I came down while he was halfway through his workout, which was early for me. Do you know this nigga grabbed his gun thinking I was an intruder, even though he had our house fully equipped with surveillance cameras and a security system like we lived in the damn White House? Not only that, but lately, Corporate had been trying to push for me to use my driver more instead of driving myself. I hated to see my man stressed out. I felt it in the way the nigga had been fucking me lately, too. He'd been fucking me like he needed me, and my pussy was where he found peace. I felt it in the way he spooned me. For one, my man didn't even like cuddling, because our body heat mixed together caused sweat, and lately now, this nigga had been trying to have me live in his skin at night, and I couldn't say that I hated it. He'd been more vocal about his love for me, too. I felt that everything was going to work out, and this was just the rough patch that we had to get through. These will forever be the most beautiful horses I've ever laid eyes on. I don't think I ever asked you this before, Pleasure, but what got you into horses? Emma, the owner of the company, asked me. She ran a family business that consisted of her and her two daughters. They loved horses and had decided to make a business of it and clean horses for a living. Emma was a 56-year-old white woman, and her daughters were 24-year-old twins. All three of them were in love with Chance and Lucky. They voiced it whenever they could. Just like me, Emma chose to work because her husband was a filthy rich investor. She and I have had girl talk plenty of times, and she told me how her husband just wanted her to be a stay-at-home wife, but she wanted to get out there and get a bag, just like the next person. I had a lot of respect for her. I didn't grow up like you all with horses. My grandmother raised me, and she didn't take me horseback riding. I didn't ride my first horse until I was 26 years old, and my husband took me. A lot of people view corporate as this big, mean person, but I swear my husband can be so sweet. The day he took me horseback riding, I'd been in bed that morning with severe cramps. I've always had that kind of cramps where it felt like I was dying. He used to sit right in bed with me and rub my stomach while telling me how he wished he had some kind of magic power to take all the pain that I was experiencing for himself. When the pain finally died down, he wanted to get me out of the house. He took me out to Davie, where they have ranches. This man pulled up to a field where they kept these beautiful horses. I had no idea he was going to ask me to get on a horse. I thought he was just bringing me there to look at them. I was hesitant at first, but eventually I got on. I'm glad I did, though. I got up there, sat up high, and it was just a peaceful feeling. In that temporary moment, nothing else seemed to matter. I wouldn't stop talking about that horse to corporate. For days, I went on and on about how much I enjoyed horseback riding and how I couldn't wait to do it again. My 27th birthday was around the corner, and that's when he surprised me with Lucky. I've just been in love with horses ever since, I said, finding myself smiling as I told Emma the story. She had a big smile on her face, too, as she listened to me. It just made me think of the good days with corporate. Don't get me wrong, these are still good days with him, but man, when he and I first got together, hell, that first year of marriage alone, I was trying to pack myself up and live in that nigga's balls. That was just how much I loved and obsessed over him. After chatting with Emma and one of her daughters, Emily, for a while longer, I went back into the house. I left my shoes at the door and walked through the house in just my socks until I made it to the stairs where my house shoes were. Miss Bernice was in the kitchen, and when I found her, she was cleaning out the stove, which didn't need any cleaning because when she was there 2 days ago, she cleaned it. I loved Miss Bernice, though. That was my girl. She reminded me of a grandmother figure. I talked so much trash in the beginning about us not needing a housekeeper, but he insisted, and I was glad I had her in my life. Miss Bernice, I don't know why you be cleaning up all that stuff like you didn't just clean it the other day, I stated, taking a seat on one of the bar stools facing the island. She laughed and waved me off. Miss Bernice had on a black collared shirt with a patch on the left side that said Bernice's Cleaning Service. We were her only clients. Corporate made sure of that. Not to take money out of her pocket by keeping her to himself either, because trust me, the man paid her what she could probably make from cleaning 10 houses in one day, and that was for each visit. Corporate did that because he loved Miss Bernice like a grandmother figure, just as I did. He didn't want her going from town to town cleaning all those houses every day, so he hired her as our own personal housekeeper, and it had been that way for years. Miss Bernice was family. She and her family could come over whenever Corporate had things at the house, and even on her off days, Corporate would call to check in on her and see how she was doing. Now, you know I'm going to clean it anyway. You need to find you somewhere and sit down, Pleasure. You look tired. Every time I look at you these days, you seem like you're running off very little sleep. What's going on? Miss Bernice fussed, putting her hand on her hip as she waited for my response. She wasn't the first person to say that to me. I was on FaceTime with Nene yesterday while she was on break at work, and the first thing she said when my face appeared on the screen was that I looked like I could use a nap. My grandmother, who didn't have a filter in this world, saw me yesterday and told me I looked like I was losing weight. I mean, a bitch was tired, but that's what happened when you're in charge of so many things. I was running the office building. Corporate had me in charge of running one of the warehouses. And lately, this nigga had been calling last minute meetings. So yes, a bitch was tired. Then, as tired as I was, I'd try to thug it out and wait up each night for my man to come home. With the shit that we had going on in the street, it was kind of hard these days to fall asleep at night without Corporate in the bed with me. I know. I'm going to go lay down now. I was just checking to see if you needed me, I lied, knowing damn well I had planned to sit down there and chop it up with her while she cleaned. No, I don't. So go lay down. I have it. I'll see Emma out when she leaves, and I'll let her know that you're upstairs taking a nap, Miss Bernice said, basically telling me in a nice way to take my ass on. Okay. Standing up from the stool, I pushed it back in and went upstairs. I went in my purse, grabbed some hundreds out, and went back downstairs with the money. I sat it on the counter and told Miss Bernice to pay Emma with that before she left. She let me know she would, and then I went back upstairs. I'd been outside for a while with Emma, and I'd even helped out a little with cleaning my horses, so before getting in bed, I took a shower. Since it was cold as hell in the house, I threw on one of my husband's sweatshirts, a pair of tights, and socks before getting in bed and putting a throw blanket around me. I swear, the second I got comfortable, my phone started ringing with a FaceTime call from corporate, because he was watching your ass on the camera. What you expect, crazy girl? Anyway, it happens all the time. Literally. I already had my mind set on a nap, and I just prayed he wasn't calling me to meet him somewhere. I answered the call, and his handsome face popped up on the screen. I could tell he was in a car, but he wasn't driving. "What's up, Daddy?" I answered, followed by a yawn, and then I rested my head on a pillow. "You okay? You sick?" he asked, and I laughed. I didn't take naps. My body is always on go, and the fact that he saw me taking a nap in the middle of the day had him thinking that something might have been wrong with me. "I'm good. I'm just tired, baby. Miss Bernice told me to lay my ass down," I told him. "You got a temperature?" he asked. "Corporate, I'm not sick. I'm just tired. Where you going? Who with you?" I inquired. "Me. So watch what the fuck you say to my brother while I'm sitting right here. Y'all be doing and saying nasty ass shit to each other like it's not other motherfuckers in the room," I heard Kaotic's deep, annoying voice say in the background. That was my brother, and I loved him, but he got on my damn nerves. "That's my husband. I'll do and say whatever I want to do or say to him. Y'all just gonna have to learn to look in the other direction," I let him know. Corporate had turned the camera on Kaotic, who was sitting on the other side of the car. From the looks of things, he was rolling a blunt. They were in the back seat of an Escalade, having a driver take them wherever they were going. "Whatever. Hey, now that I got you on the phone, let me ask you something. Nigga, we not doing all that. Baby, go to sleep. You look tired," Corporate stated, cutting his brother off. "Wait, nigga, I'ma be quick. P. Nene fucking somebody. You don't even gotta lie for her. It's just a yes or no question," he said. I started laughing. I would never sell my girl out, especially not to her crazy ass baby daddy, who would more than likely go looking for the nigga and kill him just for the fuck of it. Niggas were a special kind of fucking creature, I tell you. This nigga had a whole bitch, and he even brought the bitch to KJ's birthday party, yet he had the nerve to be questioning me about if my best friend was fucking somebody. Niggas. Kaotic, don't you have a bitch? Why you worrying about what Nene got going on? That's my baby mama. I'm supposed to worry about what the fuck she got going on. That's what baby daddies do. He shot, and I laughed. No, nigga, that's where baby daddies go wrong. Y'all be worried about everything except the damn kids. Your only focus should be KJ, not what Nene got going on in her personal life. The fact that you even saying all that lets me know she fucking somebody. Say less, he finished. I rolled my eyes, not even about to entertain Kaotic anymore with this dumbass conversation. However, I was going to call my girl tonight once she got settled in after work and let her know that if she was fucking somebody, to be a bit sneakier about it because her baby daddy had his radar on. He could smell that her ass was over there fucking. I really didn't think Nene was messing with anyone because she would have told me her ass worked so much that I didn't even see her having the time to even date anymore. As I was still on the FaceTime call with corporate, Koi started calling me via FaceTime too, but I ignored her calls until I wrapped up the call with my husband. "Tell that other nigga to stop calling you. It's my time," corporate stated, being sarcastic. "What other nigga, Daddy? Please don't start acting crazy like your damn brother. You know my pussy only gets wet for you," I had to let him know. "It's the shit I be talking about, bro. Why you gotta say nasty ass shit like that when there's other people around?" Kaotic spoke up again. I cracked up with laughter because the nigga was really upset that I was nastily talking to my damn husband. That wasn't even the worst I could say. I would call my husband in a second and tell him to come home because I wanted to gag on that big black dick and not give a fuck who he was around. Oh, baby, my mouth could be very disrespectful. Corporate loved when I talked provocative to him because he had a smirk on his handsome face as he stared at me, ignoring his brother's rants. I'm just fucking with you. I know that pussy only gets moist for me. Get your rest, baby. Something about my wife taking a nap at 5 in the evening just don't sit right with me. You don't typically do shit like that, so a nigga's worried you might be sick, he stated. Corporate, I'm fine. Be safe. You know I need you. I had to let him know. I'm always safe. I love you, baby. Juicy too, he added, causing me to blush. This man didn't ever leave my pussy out of the equation, so he had to make sure he expressed his love for her too. I love you more, daddy. Kaotic, be my nigga's extra set of ears and his eyes behind his head. Guard his life like he would guard yours, I preached. My brother good when he with me. Take your flaw ass to bed since you not trying to come up off no information about my baby mama, he snapped. I laughed again and just hung the phone up because I wasn't about to go back and forth with Kaotic about this shit. When I hung up, I thought about calling Corey back, but I knew we would get on the phone and talk for hours, which would lead to me not taking a nap. And I needed that damn nap. Before I could even make that decision, she called me back on FaceTime. For her to be calling me back to back, it was probably important. So with my head on the pillow, I went ahead and answered. Hey, I said. From her surroundings, I could tell she was at the nail salon, sitting in one of the massage chairs, probably getting a pedicure. From the looks of things, the bitch was doing just fine, and I should have never answered the phone. Why you in the bed? You sick? She asked, sounding just like my damn husband. No, I'm about to take a nap. I'ma call you when I get up. Bitch, I only answer because you kept calling, and I thought your ass was dying. How long you gonna be asleep? I need you to ride with me somewhere tonight. I rolled my eyes. Ride with you where? To pull up on O'Shane. He in West Palm Beach, talking about he's there for business, but I feel like the nigga's fucking lying to me. I have his location on my phone and I want to pull up on him. Just ride with me. I ain't asking you to jump in and help me fight the bitch if it's one there with him, she let out, and I started laughing. Coy and O'Shane got on my fucking nerves. The two of them were worse than Nene and Kaotic with how fucking toxic their relationship was. And they ain't even share a baby. When I met Coy years ago at the strip club, she was bisexual. Hell, the bitch was still bisexual, but these days, she'd been fucking with niggas more. O'Shane had this bitch's head the fuck gone, and every time she came around me, there were different scratches on her hands and shit because she really tussled with that nigga. Coy met O'Shane through my husband. O'Shane was a damn genius when it came to cars, and he fixed all the cars at the Enterprise. He owned multiple car shops throughout South Florida. The nigga was fine, and he was paid. He ain't have any kids, but he loved fucking women. I really felt that O'Shane loved Coy, but he loved fucking hoes too, and that's where he went wrong. Don't get me wrong, Coy's ass wasn't a saint either, because she still had bitches and niggas that she dealt with, but none of the people she dealt with had ever confronted O'Shane on some messy shit like his hoes had done with Coy. Those bitches would write to her on her social media accounts or walk up to her in public and say something. The girl just really be having too fucking much going on, but because everything in my life had been so serious and stressful, I wouldn't mind taking that drive with her tonight after I woke up. O'Shane and Coy were known for putting on a shit show, and I wanted front row seats to watch it go down. All right, well, let me sleep for a few hours and I'll go. I'm not driving, so come pick me up, I let her know. I got you. It ain't like you to be in the bed, though, taking a nap. I expect this from Asia. You pregnant? She asked. Get off my phone, Coy. Text me when you're on the way, I snapped. She cracked up as I hung up the phone on her. A bitch can't even lay down without people putting shit in the air talking about I'm pregnant. After placing my phone on Do Not Disturb, I put it on the charger because I ain't need anyone waking me up from my sleep. I had an alarm set that would wake me up in 3 hours. I picked up the remote from my nightstand, which controlled the white shades in my room. We had the blackout blinds in our bedroom, so once I closed them, the bedroom was pitch black, and I laid my head on the pillow. I swear, all it took was 2 minutes before I was out like a light. And there's a break in the chapter, child. Listen. All right, had to wet my whistle a little bit. 4 hours later. Okay, so my question to you is, what you gonna do if we get to the location and the nigga not even there with the bitch? We just gonna accept the fact that this was a blank trip and you gonna apologize to the nigga for accusing him of fucking around? I asked Coy once we were 10 minutes from the destination. This bitch was really going off the location from the nigga's phone. I'm not knocking any woman for doing shit like this because I know the desperate measures that a woman will feel provoked to take due to a nigga pushing her there. Before corporate, I had my fair share of niggas who had me fucked up, so I had to pull up on them and nut up. With my husband, though, corporate never gave me reasons to feel like he was cheating on me, which is why I was shocked that I believed Rhodesia when she told me she saw corporate out with another bitch. A bitch had never confronted me about my man. I'd never seen screenshots of him texting other bitches, and I didn't have social media, so a bitch had never hopped in my inbox attempting to come to me as a woman. Pleasure. I'm not gonna be wrong. My woman's intuition is telling me that he's with another bitch. Now, when the nigga came to me yesterday and said he was leaving for West Palm Beach in the morning for business, I felt like he was lying anyway. Oh, Shane rarely just ups and leaves to go somewhere because the nigga is so anal and loves to have his days planned out. Even though West Palm is just an hour away, another red flag was when the nigga said he was gonna stay there. Why not just come back home? Also, I've been purposely FaceTiming him at random times today, trying to catch the nigga slipping. He'll text me and say he's handling business, or he'll just call back regular and not through FaceTime. I'm slapping the shit out of him and beating the bitch up too, she stated, as she weaved in and out of traffic, damn near about to kill a bitch. I picked up my bottle of water that I had in her cup holder and drank some of it. Please, God, don't let it be a bitch in there, I said, putting my hands together like I was praying. Coy seemed to have already made up her mind that O'Shane was with the bitch because she just waved my prayer off and kept driving. Oh, my God. That's because she knows something that already that she ain't shared with your ass, bestie or not. Shit, some of these hoes don't be, you know, completely transparent about why they do the fuck shit that they do with these niggas. Anyway, we eventually reached an area with some nice townhomes. When we pulled up to the house where the GPS had sent us, right there in the driveway was O'Shane's Royal Green Charger. The good thing was that there wasn't an extra car in the driveway, which might mean that the nigga was by himself. Coy parked the car, purposely pulling in right behind O'Shane to block him in, and this bitch started putting Vaseline on her face. She stepped out of the car, making sure her Nike tennis shoes were tied extra tight. If there was a bitch in there, we wouldn't know how many, so I came in my tracksuit with sneakers on. My hair was in a bun, just in case I had to beat a bitch's ass, too. My gun was on my hip because I never left the house without it. I know that's right. And Coy stayed strapped, just as I did, so I knew without even asking that she was packing, too. She walked with purpose up to the porch and banged on the door, using her hand to cover the peephole. The nigga couldn't even deny that he was there because his car was parked right out front. Coy started banging again, this time even harder, and her knocks lasted longer. 5 minutes later, O'Shane finally opened the door. The nigga was in just his briefs, and I caught a quick glimpse of that print. All I could say was it made sense to me now why Coy had me out at 11 at night looking for this nigga. In no way was I trying to be disrespectful, but the nigga was fine. I'd always thought O'Shane was handsome, though. He was tall and buff, and because he was just wearing briefs, all his tattoos were on display. He had long locks, that hung past his shoulders, and his eyes were red like he had been sleeping, and Coy had awakened him with her loud-ass knocking. Coy, bro, what the fuck you got going on? Didn't we just talk about that crazy-ass shit your ass be doing? Why the fuck you drove all the way down here if I told you that I'm here handling fucking business? O'Shane roared, grabbing Coy by her hips and trying to stop her from getting into the house. She was determined, so I knew she was going to make her way inside. At first, I ain't believe the nigga had a bitch in there with him. I swear, on the whole drive over, I felt like O'Shane really came to West Palm Beach for business, and Coy was just tripping. But my woman's intuition had kicked in, too, and I could now see where Coy was coming from. Now, although I wasn't fully in the house to see if there were any feminine items lying around, it was the mere fact that I was standing right by the doorway and there was a sweet, fruity scent that more than likely came from a bitch who was probably upstairs, and Coy was determined to get up there. If it's just business, why you won't let me in the house then, O'Shane? She wanted to know while he was still holding her. Because why the fuck my word not good enough? P, get your girl, man. She fucking tripping, he shot, putting his eyes on me. That's where he went wrong, because as soon as he lost focus, Coy was able to muscle her way out of his grip. She hauled ass for the stairs, taking them two at a time, just knowing it was a bitch up there. O'Shane took off after her, and the fact that he did let me know somebody was up there. I walked into the house, closed the door behind me, and locked it. I heard a woman scream, and that voice didn't belong to Coy, so Sure enough, a bitch was up there. I jogged up the stairs because I knew Koi was angry and I ain't want her to get up there and kill the bitch. Plus, you wanted to see it, bitch. I made it to the master bedroom and Koi already had the naked woman on her back, beating her ass. All the while, O'Shane was struggling to get Koi off her. Koi wasn't even a big girl. She was shorter and a little smaller than me, so if O'Shane really wanted to, he could just fling her ass off the woman. But the nigga was struggling. He eventually grabbed Koi and threw her ass into the wall. She swung her arms, slapping and punching that nigga all in his face. Be mad at me. Damn, why you gotta come in here charging at the bitch? I fucked up. Not her, O'Shane pleaded. Koi was crying angry tears. I knew she was mad because this wasn't her first time catching O'Shane with a bitch. I knew the shit had to hurt because she really did like him. She had expressed that shit to me on several occasions, and the shit that was probably the hardest for her was the fact that she was just with this nigga last night. I called her last night just to check in, and I heard the nigga in the background. He probably fucked Koi and everything else, only for the nigga to drive up to West Palm the next morning. O'Shane had probably been with that bitch all day, and the fact that the bitch was naked and all he had on was his briefs proved that they'd been fucking too. Yeah, that shit gotta hurt. The thing is, Koi and O'Shane weren't officially together, but they were, if that made sense. Like, they were locked in, but they weren't a couple. They fucked raw, but they were still single. That's where she fucked up right there. Why you fucking this nigga raw and you know he's still fucking other bitches? Girl, bye. Man, I don't fucking know. The girls who get it, get it. The girls who don't, don't. Don't stand here and defend this bitch. O'Shane, you fucked her with a condom? She screamed. She had every right to ask him that question, though. Koi, I... Answer the motherfucking question. Did you fuck her with a condom? She screamed again. Yeah, man, I'm only fucking with you without one. And let me go. Let me the fuck go. I just can't. You are one dirty ass nigga, and I'm sick and tired of you having me out here looking fucking stupid. We just fucked all night last night, O'Shane. Your dick was in every hole. Then you drove your ass down here and fucked this bitch. Had the nerve to look at me when I popped up like I'm fucking crazy, knowing the shit you were doing. Man, fuck you. She barked and punched the nigga dead in his jaw. O'Shane flinched like he was gonna hit her ass back, but he didn't. He did, however, let her hips go. Koi slapped the shit out of him again before she moved past him. There was no need to even go back over to the bitch because she was beat down, lying on the floor leaking blood from her face. Koi just stepped over her and ran down the stairs with me following. O'Shane ran out of the room too and down the stairs trying to catch up with Koi, but she was hauling ass. We eventually made it outside and he came out too. This man was still in his briefs. Koi made it to the car just in time. When he tried to pull on the handle, I jumped in front of him. O'Shane, you gotta let her calm down, nigga. What she just had to take in was a lot. Nigga, you standing here with fresh hickeys on your neck. I can smell that bitch's scent on you. You was with Koi yesterday, and now you with a whole other bitch today. Even though you and Koi not official, the feelings y'all have for each other are deep. And nigga, you fucked up. Just go back in the house, I warned. I knew he wanted to fight for Koi, but he backed away. And then I got in the passenger seat. Before I could even put my seatbelt on, Koi pulled out of the driveway. You want me to drive? I asked, although I hated driving in the dark. My girl was hurting, so I didn't mind taking the wheel. It's cool. I'm done, P. I swear I am. It's hurting me more than it's making me happy to be with this nigga. I can't do this shit no more, she vented. I ain't even respond because, for one, I ain't feel like I had the right words. And secondly, I knew Koi wasn't done for real. She and O'Shane stayed going through shit. And then they would sweep shit under the rug and be back to being lovers. What I did know was that the two of them gave me a damn headache, like my head was literally aching. I knew for a fact, though, that my head wasn't aching as bad as the bitch who Koi just beat up. Her ass had to be in a shitload of pain. And that's the end of that chapter. Lord, hamburger and french fries. Okay. I tell you what, I'm not finna fight nary a bitch over a nigga. Mm-mm. Nope. Child, if you want to take his body with you, go right ahead. My beef is with this nigga, not you, ma'am. You know, unless you happen to be a bitch I fuck with. Then in that case, I hope you said goodbye to your chillin' and paid up your insurance. Hey, sweet November. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. And you too, Nakia. And you too, M. Royce. And she said, I'm finishing up Saved by Being There too, but wanted to say, hey, I've been listening for months and I feel like y'all are my old friends. I hear the convos on the replay and respond to air. Aw, thank you, boo. Well, I'm glad you feel a sense of family when you come into the speakeasy. She said, hopefully I'll get my life together and catch a live part one. All right, boo. Well, thank you for catching the replay and like the video on your way out the door. Hey, Melly Mel, welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you, and you too, church lady, and you too, Jazzy. Yes, everybody's in the building. Okay, not double time. Hey, F girl, just stopping in to say hello to my favorite group, Saki, Love, Jones, and Sippers. I'll have to catch this on replay. Have fun with Saki and her hilarious commentary. I'm jealous. I have to work. Aw, well, hopefully you'll be able to catch it live soon, F girl. See you later and like the video on your way back to work, child. Hey, Marva, welcome. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. Buck, who likes to fuck? How you doing, boo? Thank you for being here. Nope, your phone wasn't tripping. I'm here. Loud, live, and in color, child. Trying to finish up this book because I don't know how long it's going to take. I'm trying to be quiet to make sure that we finish. And I still didn't look to see how many damn minutes it was going to be, hours or whatever the fuck. Oh, hell. Okay, it says it's just an hour and 14 minutes left in the book. Well, that's all right. We'll get through with it and be done. How about that? All right. Just a few seconds and we'll get back at it. Chapter 17, Tavon Williams. I hope I'm saying this right. Tavon or Tavon, child, I don't know. Blues Boys Territory, BB Crew. Rozzy gone, Salim gone, and we just lost five other niggas last night. I don't think I've ever been this fucking stressed out in my life. When I get stressed out like this, a motherfucker gonna have to feel me. I'm 2 seconds away from getting on some reckless shit and just pulling up to one of them fucking warehouses that Corporate and his niggas work out of and spraying that shit up. I'm willing to die behind this shit at this point. I'm losing too many fucking niggas around me and it's causing me to lose my fucking mind. I said, standing up from my chair and kicking the shit out of it. The year had just started, and it was already a fucked up one. We had lost our leader, Rozzy, the glue that kept our crew together. He was the brains, the biggest hustler I knew, and the one who kept money in a lot of niggas' pockets. Only Rozzy had a bond with the plug that we copped our work from because he refused to deal with anyone else. The BB crew was known for being reckless. We ain't playing shit out, and we stirred up a lot of shit, so not too many plugs were willing to work with us. Rozzy was able to get in good with this Mexican cat, and we've been copping work from them for years. Rozzy handled all the meetings and shit with the plug Bruno that none of us could attend. When Rozzy died and I tried to step up and build a relationship with Bruno, he wouldn't let me talking about he only wanted to work with Rozzy. That left us hungry. We had a gang of niggas who needed some money in their pockets, and I was the new leader who had to find a way for us to get this money, but I kept coming up empty-handed. We literally had to start from the ground up, and I was stuck. It was no secret that Corporate and his niggas were eating. His fucking corner boys were wearing VVS chains, watches, and pushing nice whips. Them niggas ate lovely over there. And for as long as I can remember, that crew had always supplied the streets with the best, purest drugs. I'm not gonna lie, there was a time when I wished I had been put on with them niggas instead of BB, but shit, it was too late to switch now. I bled blues, boy. Had that shit tatted on my face, and those niggas were my family, so I'd never switch to the other side. Although them niggas weren't responsible for killing Rozzy, they popped Salim and sent his head to one of our traps, leaving it right on the porch. That was a signature move for the Strong organization, but even if we didn't know how to read between the lines that they had done it, the picture of the muscle that they'd sent with Salim's head, which represented Strong, proved that it was them. They took a nigga from me that I loved and considered family. Because we were already hurting from losing Rozzy, we went hunting and found two niggas who worked for Corporate. We grabbed them niggas up, beat the fuck out of them, hung them, and text photos of that shit, letting them niggas know what the fuck it was right now. Granted, we did start this shit. Salim went snooping and the nigga lost his life because of it. Because we started this, we were gonna finish the motherfucker too. See, we had work left over from when Rosie was alive, and that's what we've been pushing out in the streets. I got a call from one of my corner boys a few weeks ago telling me that corporate put his niggas on our block. In this line of business, that was one of the most disrespectful things anyone can do. Taking money out of the other side's pockets basically sent a message loud and clear that not one fuck was given about them, and there was no respect. We'd been losing a lot of niggas left and right, not just from our niggas being killed, but from disloyal-ass niggas who weren't willing to ride this shit out until we came up with a plan. So they walked away from this shit. Since that was the case, when corporate put his niggas on our block, we were outnumbered. It wouldn't have been smart on our side to challenge that, so I had made my men get off the block. It looked like we were pussy and scared of them, but in reality, we were plotting. I swore on my motherfucking kids that by the time I got done with them niggas, there would be no one left standing in that bitch-ass Strong organization. Nigga, chill the fuck out. You kicking shit and acting all fucking crazy is not gonna help the situation. Now's not the time to be wilding out. We gotta put our fucking heads together and come up with some shit. I got my faith in Amiri, though. That nigga comes home in a couple more months from prison, and you know before he went in, he had got in good with a plug. That nigga gonna help us get on our feet, man. Relax. You stressing me the fuck out, too, my homie Bray snapped as he passed me the blunt. I took it from him, knowing I needed it, and took a long pull. The chair that I'd kicked over, I picked it up and set it back down as I thought about what he just said. Amiri was a nigga we used to run with years ago, but that nigga got picked up about 14 years ago on some drug charges. But it wasn't enough for the man to get hit with a life sentence. He had 12 years to serve, but that nigga was a hothead in there fighting and shit, so they added more time to a sentence, which is why he'd been locked up for a little over 14 years. Amiri went in a year before we started up Blues Boy. Rosie was the one who came up with the shit, and I went with it. At first, it was just supposed to be a gang out of Miami, which it still is. But then we started leaning into making this shit a big-ass drug empire like the Strong organization. But we haven't made it that big yet. Our time was coming, though. I'm curious about how that shit is gonna work when Amiri comes home, though. I'm not even gonna lie. Remember him and Pleasure used to fuck around back when she was dancing. That nigga was fucked up over that fine-ass black Barbie. You know I be on the phone with the nigga, and he's still hollering about how he coming home for his bitch. He don't fear corporate the way a lot of niggas do. Bray let me know. I had totally forgotten that Amiri used to fuck around with Pleasure. They never got into a relationship or no shit like that, but the nigga was heavily fucked up about her. His black ass stayed in the strip club watching her dance. They messed around for a couple of years, and then the nigga got sentenced. He'd only been in for 2 years when the rumor started about Pleasure messing around with corporate. That bitch was so disloyal, she couldn't even hold my nigga down. Pause. Would he have fucking held her down if she was the one who was doing the sentence and him and his raggedy-ass dick and leaky-ass balls was out here free? Fuck no. He wouldn't be up all night jerking his fucking McGurkin while she was serving her time. No, he'd be trying to twist and tangle every bitch he could find up into a slipknot while lying to her, telling her he being faithful. So fuck his bitch ass, nigga. You did the crime, you do the time. I ain't your fucking wife, so I'm not obligated to serve not nary a fucking second of that fucking long-ass sentence you got with you. Fuck you. Shit. The fuck? Niggas got the game all fucked up. Hell, the mustard's off the hot dog, nigga, and the Vaseline has been wiped off the lens. Fuck you, motherfuckers. You get pinched, nigga? Do your fucking time. Don't expect for nobody to wait for you, motherfucker, but the I, the R, and the S. Them motherfuckers waiting for you to get out, get a job so you can pay your fucking taxes. But ain't nobody else obligated to wait on your bitch ass. Hell, the fuck? Thanks for coming to my TED Talk. Anyway, you're gonna have to find another black Barbie. That bitch gotta go too. I wanna wipe the whole fucking family out. We can start tomorrow. I've been having somebody watch that nigga's schedule. He gonna be at the warehouse tomorrow. We gonna pull up, follow him from there, and spray that nigga. I don't give a fuck if his kid's out there. We wetting up everything. They taking niggas away from me. That's family. They made us hurt, so we gotta make them hurt too. Them two niggas of theirs that we popped just wasn't enough, I vented. Shit, I'm on whatever you on, Bray responded, telling me everything I needed to hear. I shook it up with him, and we left it at that. Tomorrow was gonna be a dangerous day, and not everyone would make it back alive, but that was the risk we took when we got ourselves involved with this shit. I was willing to die behind BB, but when I died, I was gonna take out as many niggas from the Strong organization as I possibly could. And that's the end of that chapter. So he just a whack-ass, weak-ass nigga, basically. Old hating-ass nigga. Shine your fucking head up, nigga.
The fuck?
All right. So that was the end. Hey, Irk and Jerk, welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. And you too, Danielle. Welcome, welcome. So Buck said, all right, fam, I'm listening, but it's time to get back on this big road. All right. Well, you be careful, Buck. Drive carefully. And thanks for listening. Hey, Shaniqua Nash, welcome to the Speakeasy. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. Y'all welcome, Shaniqua. All right, let me get this damn timestamp. Child, I said, I don't know what the hell. Okay, I got it here. Okay, so we just got to let it count down a little bit. Chapter 18, Pleasure Strong. I hope you're not expecting me to cook when we get home either. I slapped something in the air fryer for you, I said to my husband as I walked into his office, holding some documents for the Enterprise company. He had me at the warehouse, but I was doing work for a completely different business of his. The air fryer comment was our inside joke because he felt that when a bitch put food in the air fryer, her ass was lazy. In his words, he wasn't the kind of nigga that you put some shit in the air fryer for because he was too good of a nigga to me for that. He was right, though, but I loved my air fryer, and I was going to continue making some of my meals in it. Okay. Oh, my God, child, listen. All right. She was like, I don't give a fuck what you got to say. I'm going to keep using it. I'm going to throw that fucking air fryer in the trash. I like my food made either in the oven or on the stove, he stated, looking up from his desktop screen to focus his attention on me. It was after 9 at night, and the only people in the office was Corporate and me, Shadae, Kaotic, Kody, Kyle, Kyrie, and Keanu, pretty much the majority of the family, but we were all getting ready to head out soon. I didn't even bother responding to Corporate's comment. Instead, I went over to his file cabinet and turned the locks. Once I entered the code and gained access, I put the important documents inside, making sure to keep it in order because my anal-ass husband would get on me hard for putting shit in the wrong spot. Where you want to go? Corporate asked. I could feel his eyes on me the whole time I was standing in front of the file cabinet. I closed it back and walked over to him, standing between his long, muscular legs. My arms wrapped around his neck, and he brought his large hands down, placing them on my ass while he looked up at me. It was Friday night, so Corporate was dressed down. He had on a black collared shirt, and on the left side was a muscle representing the Strong organization. Along with the shirt, he wore black jeans that fit him perfectly. My man loved Dior. It was one of his favorite designer brands, so he was wearing a casual pair of low-top Dior sneakers. The only piece of jewelry he wore was his wedding band, along with the plain Jane Rolex watch on his left wrist. He smelled amazing, too. Even after a long day of work, his waves were perfect like they always were. His beard was nice and full, and that beautiful face of his was something that still kept a bitch so deeply in love with him, even to this day. You know you don't like your food to go. I'll whip up something for you when we get home, I conceded. No, baby, not like that. A trip. Somewhere out of the country. Where you want to go? We've been working so fucking hard, and I just want to take a break from this shit for a few weeks. You told me some shit a while back, and I can't get that shit out of my head. You said how lately you've been feeling like you've just been getting Corporate the business partner, and not Corporate the husband. Sitting back and looking at this shit, I can see why you would say that. I'm still spoiling you. I'm still giving you expensive shit, but I do see where I'm lacking in the time department. I don't be taking my wife on dates or none of that shit because I've been so busy with the business. So I'm asking you where you want to go. No place is off limits, he stated. I smiled big because I didn't think anyone understood how much I had been waiting for my husband to ask me something like that. It had just been all work these days and no pleasure. It felt like he could read my mind because I was just thinking the other day about how I wanted a vacation, but I felt that the timing was off, so I hadn't said anything. Ooh, you know Fiji has been on my list for a while now. We can go there, I smiled. Corporate and I had traveled. It said had to traveled, but I think what she meant was Corporate and I had traveled plenty of countries together or traveled to. They transposed it. But I can read. We'd been to so many islands, explored other cultures, and tried different foods, but it had been a while since we'd done those things. When Corporate and I first met, my ass didn't even have a passport. It wasn't that I couldn't afford to take luxury trips before meeting him because my stripping bag was big, but I just never thought big enough to want to leave the country. When I got with corporate, getting a passport was one of the first things he made me do. Once I got it, the first place he took me to was Jamaica because he knew how much I loved Caribbean food. God, that was one of the best trips of my life. All right, I'll make it happen. Let me wrap this shit up and then we can head out, he said. I leaned in and kissed his lips. I really was just trying to give him a quick peck and go on about my business, but his grip on my ass got tighter and he was looking at me like he expected another kiss. So I leaned my head back down and this time we tongue kissed. In the middle of the kiss, there was a knock on his office door. Whoever had just knocked walked right on in without the okay to come inside. I figured it was one of Corporate's brothers who did that shit. Kaotic and Kody were the only ones bold enough to do shit like that. Man, wrap this shit up. You act like you ain't see this nigga all day, Cody's deep voice boomed in the office. I didn't immediately pull away from my husband, but after kissing some more, I did remove my lips from his, wiped away some of the excess lip gloss from his lips, and turned to look at Kaotic and Kody, who were both standing in the office. I heard heels clicking, heading our way, and it wasn't long before Shadae was standing in the office, too. One day, I'ma just forget that y'all dumbasses are my brothers, and I'ma just shoot the fuck out of both of y'all for walking in my office without me telling y'all to come in, Corporate snapped. He hit me on my ass, and I backed up so he could stand. Y'all shouldn't be doing inappropriate shit like that on a job then, and you wouldn't have to worry about getting caught, Kody responded as he took a seat in one of the chairs. A Corporate just ignored his brother and walked over to his mom and Kaotic. The three of them started talking, leaving Kody and me by the desk where I was still standing. He looked over at me and started laughing. Oh, yeah, why you let your girl pull up on my nigga the other night and start wilding like that? He asked. I already knew he was referring to what took place the other night between Coy and O'Shane. Like I said, O'Shane was like family, and Corporate and his brothers were really close with him. There was no telling what version of the story O'Shane gave his niggas, though. He probably made my girl out to be some psychopath who popped up on him and a bitch while they were just in the living room doing Bible study. Niggas will really lie and tell their version of the story instead of what really took place. What O'Shane told you? I asked, crossing my arms, curious to hear what Kody had to say. Kody laughed, showing off the two dimples in his face. Kody was very handsome. He ain't really look like Corporate or Kaotic to me, but he was Shadae's twin all damn day. He did have the same chocolate skin as his brothers and their crazy ass ways, but that was pretty much it. Kody had top and bottom goals in his mouth, which I hated because he had beautiful white teeth. Luckily, they were pullouts and weren't permanent. Back in the day, I used to have a thing for a nigga with gold teeth, but these days, I take a fresh set of pearly whites on a nigga any day. Kody didn't have the same tall, athletic build like his brothers. Instead, he was tall and slim. He'd gotten his height from his dad, but the slimness came from Shadae because she was little as hell. He did have the signature strong waves, though, and he took his waves just as serious as the rest of the men. Perfect skin with a perfect smile. Kody was the brother who would hit me up and tell me to meet him somewhere for drinks. I held a special bond with each of Corporate's brothers, but Kody and I had a good relationship from the moment we met. He may have gotten on my damn nerve just as much as Kaotic did, but I loved his annoying ass. P, O'Shane said he ain't even fucked that girl. That's a fucking lie. That girl was upstairs in the bed naked, I responded, cutting him off. Kody started cracking up. Gee, shit, P. O'Shane said he ain't fuck her. That nigga wouldn't lie to me about no shit like that. He would have been honest with me if he smashed the bitch. He said that when y'all pulled up, the girl had just gotten out of the shower and Coy came in wilding, he responded, and I sucked my teeth. That nigga had fresh hickeys on his neck, and Coy already told me she didn't put them there. That bitch wasn't getting out of the damn shower. Her eyes were just as red as O'Shane's when I saw her, which means the two of them had been in bed sleeping. Believe your lying ass friend if you want to. See, God knew not to put me in those kinds of situations. I would have killed your brother, I told him. If pushed to that point, I was prone to black out and destroy everything in my path. I ain't take well to a nigga being disloyal, and I knew how bad my temper could get. Whatever, she did all that shit, and I bet she take that nigga right back, he stated, and left it at that because Corporate had walked over with Shadae. Shadae really looked like she could be their big sister. For one, they all towered over her. Corporate came over, hugged me from behind with his arms around my waist and buried his head into the crook of my neck. I reached down and put my hand on top of his and my eyes stayed on Shadae because I could tell she was getting ready to say something. Shit's been quiet lately, Hasn't been any problems with our men on the block, none of that. With things so calm, I really don't know if that's a good or a bad thing. So we just have to be prepared for whatever. We moved some of our guys to work the corners that belong to BB, and they still haven't made a move, but I feel like they may be cooking something up, so just prepare for that. After the shit that happened the other night at the trap house, we found another apartment to work from. We just have to upgrade a few niggas' positions off the corner and put them in that new trap house. Niggas that we know we can trust, because we don't need a part two of what Petey's stupid ass had going on in that trap, Shadae stated. I nodded in agreement, but I also spoke up about something that had been on my mind since I found out about what happened at the trap. Do y'all feel like we should be worried about Petey, though? Corporate beat the shit out of him, fired him, and basically stopped the nigga from eating. If he wanted to get his get back, I mean, he knows where all the warehouses are located, and he knows the drop-off and pickup days of our shipments. Is that something we should be worried about? I questioned. When I finished asking my question, Corporate kissed me on my neck and pulled away from me. I knew he would be the one to answer my question. At the same time, Kyle, Kyrie, and Keanu walked into the office since the door was open. I thought about that, too. I mean, it's something worth thinking about. I don't view Petey as a threat, though. If I did, I would have killed the nigga that night. He decided to turn my fucking trap house into a mini club. It's cool for the nigga to know his way to the warehouses, but can the nigga get in is the question. Even on days when we have drop-offs and pickups, ain't no way he would even make it on that fucking yacht where that shit goes down. If the nigga feel a type of way because I beat him down and fired him, then I'd like to see the nigga do something about it, Corporate responded. As he spoke, for some reason, my eyes landed on Kyle. His ass always had some kind of objection, and lately, he'd been challenging a lot of shit that Corporate said, so I wanted to watch his facial expression. Surprisingly, his ass didn't say anything, though. He just stood back and listened to everyone else weigh in on the issue. Pause. That's because that stanky back bastard is in on the shit, because he want to fuck with Petey. Not fuck with him like that, but do business with him. Pop's 57th birthday is coming up. I ain't really hear nobody saying anything about that. How we plan on celebrating my nigga this year? Kody asked, switching the subject. Each year, we had something big to celebrate Kato. Although I didn't personally know him and had just heard stories, with each year that passed, I felt closer to Kato. From the many stories that I heard about him from my husband, his brother, Shadae, and even Kanye would tell me stories about his uncle Kato, I felt like I had learned enough to know who he was. Y'all be having all these parties every year for Kato, knowing damn well that if my brother was here, he wouldn't have wanted a party. Kato hated celebrations. That nigga just wanted a good drink, a nice cigar, and he was fine with that. Kyle spoke up for the first time since he'd been in the room. When he said that, Cody's jaw flinched, and I could tell he was about to let his uncle have it. Nigga, you ain't gonna stand here and tell us how to celebrate our fucking daddy. We've been throwing parties for Kato for the past 22 years since the nigga's been gone. So what the fuck is you talking about? Kody snapped. I was a little shocked because Kody was usually shits and giggles all day. He really wasn't the brother who would speak up in the meetings and shit either. He was an observer who would just sit back and watch how things played out. I couldn't say that I was shocked that he snapped because Kato was a topic that would forever be sensitive to his three children. I wasn't trying to be disrespectful by saying that. That's my brother, and I know Kato didn't care for all that party and shit. Fuck, nigga. Don't bring your ass there then, Kaotic snapped, jumping in on the conversation. Kay, you my nigga, but watch your mouth talking to my pops like that. This ain't that, Kyrie jumped in. That caused Kaotic to walk his ass over to Kyrie. Shadae tried to grab him, but he shook out of her grip and stood in front of his cousin. Nigga, this is that. Like Kody said, ain't nobody gonna tell us how to celebrate our daddy. If y'all ain't fucking with the idea of throwing Kato a party, then don't nobody have a fucking gun to y'all head. Telling y'all that y'all gotta come. Stay the fuck home if that's the case. Talking about I gotta watch my mouth. Nigga, I ain't gotta watch shit, Kaotic snapped. Kyrie just nodded and backed up a bit. I wasn't sure if I liked the idea of Kaotic and Kody going at it with Kyrie. I mean, it was one thing for them to go at it with Kyle because everybody went at it with Kyle. Hell, the nigga always had something slick to say that a lot of people didn't agree with, but no one had ever really gone at it with Kyrie. The family feuding wasn't a good idea because we already had so much shit going on with outsiders, so now was not the time to be beefing amongst ourselves. What shocked me the most was the fact that Shadae hadn't said anything. She would usually be so quick to check Kyle, but this time she ain't say a damn thing. Maybe she was just annoyed because lately there had been a lot of drama. She probably was just over it at that point. Kody did go over to Kaotic and grab his brother up. Then they walked out of the room. Next, Keanu walked out. Keanu was the youngest brother of Kato and Kyle, and he was the uncle that my husband was closest with. They had a good relationship that went further than just the business. In fact, Keanu was the uncle Korporate hit up when he wanted to attend a sporting event or play golf, because that was a sport Keanu was into. Keanu had a 29-year-old daughter named Casey, but I didn't speak on her much because she wasn't down here. She lived in Philly with her husband, and she just wasn't close with the family like that. Since I'd been with Korporate, I'd probably met Casey 4 to 5 times. A relationship between us just never formed. She was standoffish, so we never clicked. Korporate wasn't close with her either. After Kody left, Kyrie and Kyle walked out of the office, leaving myself, Korporate, and Shadae alone. Korporate looked at his mother with a smirk on his face and shook his head. Let me find out you getting fucking scary. You normally check Kyle. Why you ain't have shit to say to him? Korporate asked, literally taking the words right out of my mouth. She waved him off. Because it gets me nowhere arguing with Kyle. I'm about to go. Y'all okay? She asked. Yeah, we gonna walk out with you, Korporate responded. Soon after, he packed up his office and we were ready to go. Pause. Fuck Shadae, because that bitch scared that Kyle might say something. But I don't understand how she ain't fucking thinking that, listen, I didn't, like, she should be thinking it's her word against his, right? I didn't fuck him. That should be her response, is what I'm saying. You know, and even if they try to test the boy, and let's say for shits and giggles, it turns out that he is the pappy. Say, what I didn't tell y'all was that on such and such a night, Kyle raped me, because he threatened to tell Kato that, that I was a willing participant if I tried to tell on him. So I never said anything. And I just assumed that Kody was Kato's baby and not Kyle's. That's exactly what my story would be. Nigga, you raped me. I didn't willingly fuck you. You got me fucked up. I was loyal to my husband, nigga. And you ain't gonna tarnish or sully my relationship or my marriage. You're not gonna do that. Fuck you. Even though she did go over there and... He tried to sully her reputation by saying she a slut. Anyway, even though her husband was cheating. Her husband was cheating like a bitch, so she went over there and fucked Kyle. But anyway, whatever. Everyone else had already left. Neither Korporate nor I drove today. I'd been working alongside him all day, so our driver had been riding us around. Korporate opened the back door for me, and then he walked Shadae to her car and came back to the Escalade about 2 minutes later. Once he got in, our driver, Anders, took off. Anders had been in the picture for years. He had become like family. He'd taken Korporate on a bunch of dirty missions where he sat in the car and let my husband do his dirty work while he turned a blind eye. He was loyal. Korporate trusted him, and that's why he'd been around for so long. The nigga was a shooter, too. There had been a few situations over the years where Anders had to get active. He'd proven that he knew how to survive and could be a protector. I love the relationship my husband had with Anders, and my relationship with him was good, too. When Korporate got in the car, although we were sitting in our own seats in back of the Escalade, I still shifted my body and raised my hand to rub his waves. I could look at him and tell that there was something heavy on his mind, but I was just waiting for him to speak on it. He turned his head and kissed my hand that still played in his waves, and then he looked at me. Shadae don't ever back down. P, she did that shit for a reason, he expressed. I laughed. Korporate, I'm sure Shadae is tired of arguing with Kyle. Hell, I'm sure you're tired of going at it with his ass, too. And that's why you didn't jump down his throat either, I said. And Korporate shook his head. My reason for not getting in that shit was different, P. I'm getting so sick of that nigga that I really don't even have any more words left to give him. It's to the point now that when I get around his ass, the only thing I want to do is light his ass up. I'm sick of the nigga. And I'm sick of the dumbass shit he be letting fly out of his mouth. That's why I kept quiet. My mama kept quiet for a reason that I still don't understand. Pleasure, I saw her energy through her face when that nigga walked in the room. It wasn't just her regular energy where she's annoyed to see that nigga either. It was different. But I can't quite put my hands on that shit. You feel like I might be reaching? He asked. I left his waves alone and placed my hands in my lap, staring at him as I thought about what he just said and released a sigh. You could be looking too deep into it, but then again, I don't know. I mean, what do you think it is? You think he knows something that we don't? What could it be? You know the two of them ain't ever fucked before. I joked and laughed at my own comment, but Korporate didn't. I wasn't shocked about that because his ass never laughed at shit. Why would you even say some dumbass shit like that? He asked, and I rolled my eyes. To lighten the mood, nigga. You acting like the damn Grinch right now. I don't know what Shadae got going on. I'm sure she's just sick and tired of that nigga, which we all are. I'm gonna tell Anders to stop at that sushi spot that I like going to. That's what I want tonight for dinner. I let him know, changing the subject. I'm in the mood for a burger. I want something super fucking unhealthy, he responded, and I laughed. What? The fucking Weight Watchers police want something unhealthy? Where's my husband and who the fuck are you? I asked. That question got him to crack a smile. I won't act like all my husband does is eat super healthy foods, but for the most part, he had a clean diet. I did have my days when I would pig out, though, especially when I went out to eat with my girls. I loved my sweets, too. I would work it all off, though, because I lived in the gym each morning on a mission to keep up this tight-ass body. I loved drinking, too, so I had no choice but to stay my ass in the gym. Shit, it's me. You trying to see the birthmark on Big Man to prove that it's me? He asked, referring to the beautiful birthmark that he had on the left, on the shaft of his dick, which I swore was in the shape of a heart. I reached over, grabbed his crotch with my left hand, and rubbed it. I couldn't wait to get in the house with him so I could ride that dick all night. My man was stressed out, and his stress was rubbing off on me so we could both use a few nuts. I could have easily just closed the partition to block Anders from seeing us, but truth be told, I ain't much see the hype of fucking in the car. Don't get me wrong, I'll fuck anywhere because I've always been bold like that, but car sex limited what I could do. Exactly, child. Right, fuck around and end up with a fucking crook in your neck. Sorry, I didn't like fucking in one position for too long. Right, because your fucking leg be going numb. You be trying to put it up, you don't want to kick the fucking window out. Lord have mercy, it's just a mess. Anyway, I like to start off riding, then be flipped into doggy, picked up, fucked against the wall, all of that. Now, if my man told me to close that partition and ride that dick, oh baby, I'm coming out of these heels and this dress, and I'm going to get to work. But like I said, I just wasn't a fan of it. It's cool, baby. I know it's you. I rubbed his dick some more and removed my hand. Anders, change your plans, my man. You'll take us to Burgermeister. My wife want to wrap her lips around some juicy meat, Corporate lied, putting that shit on me. Anders laughed and told Corporate that he would take us there. Sushi sounded good, but a burger sounded 10 times better. I wanted everything piled up on my burger and double fries with my meal. The spot that we were going to was in Brickhill. I guess it's Brickle. I don't know, who give a fuck. And not too far from the house. Corporate and I had been there plenty of times. I turned back in my seat and grabbed my phone from my purse. All this time, it had been vibrating with text messages that I was sure were coming in through the group chat. I looked at my phone and I say that I missed about 30 messages in the bad bitches chat, which consisted of me, Asia, Rika, Chantel, Koi, Sanai, and Kanye. I scrolled to the top where the messages started. Kanye had started the conversation. He'd sent a video message and I opened it, just shaking my head. He was calling Sanai out, sending the video with a message that asked, "This you, boo?" I laughed because his ass was so messy. She was at a lounge smoking a hookah with a mod right next to her smoking a joint. This bitch dropped so many tears at my house over this nigga when she found out he had a baby on the way. And then she got all of us on a group FaceTime call where she spilled the tea and swore up and down that she was done messing around with a mod. She went on and on about how she was gonna get her a good man because she knew she deserved so much better. Granted, I didn't believe the bitch in the first place, but I didn't think she would go back so fast either. The nigga dogged her like he did because she allowed him to do disrespectful shit and come back to her. So Sanai sends a text that says, "If my nigga said he's sorry, then he's sorry." Pause. Bitch. He ain't sorry for what he did. He just a sorry ass nigga. Two totally different things, ma'am. But you a dummy. And that is apparent. So Asia says, "How the fuck does a nigga apologize for having a baby?" Ain't that much of my pussy shit. Asia was super blunt, just like the rest of us. I'm pausing because it's, yeah, I dropped out. I heard it. Hold on. Hold on, y'all. Hold on. I'm letting it catch up. trying to see where I went out at, because I went out on y'all. And this is why I listen to myself. Hold on. Okay. The last thing it was is, right, I left off at Asia's comment and it picked back up. All right. So let me get back up to speed with y'all. So I did drop out. I dropped out on Asia's part. So hold on. Once I catch up. Yeah, but this is why I listen to myself read to y'all. That way my video is not uploaded with missing pieces and shit. So I'm letting it catch up. Y'all just got to bear with me or not. It's up to y'all. It's about to catch up. Oh my God, listen to myself in double time speed. That's weird as shit. All right, here we go. So Asia texts back and says, how the fuck does a nigga apologize for having a baby on you? Ain't that much of my pussy he could eat to apologize for that. I read Asia's message and laughed. Asia was super blunt, just like the rest of us, but she was proper as hell. I laughed because I could hear her voice as I read the message out loud. I did like her message, though, because I agreed with what she said. And so Rika texts, what we're not going to do is sit in this chat and act like we're shocked. Sanai, I knew your ass was going back. And Sanai says, Kanye, you are so damn messy for exposing me like that. Somebody sent you that video of us, or you was at the lounge last night too, saw me, and your ass just didn't speak. And Kanye says, I'm not revealing my sources. Listen, boo, I done took a nigga back plenty of times after fucking around on me. But baby, rule number one is you not supposed to take the nigga back out loud. You supposed to be chilling in the house with the nigga so your ass don't get caught. Then you work your way into popping out on the scene with the nigga again. Have I not taught you anything? God damn. I was cracking up because I just knew Kanye was twirling his neck along with doing other dramatic hand gestures as he typed up that message. He had everyone in the group chat sending laughing emojis, and I was crying laughing as I read through those messages. That car is following us. My husband's voice stopped me from laughing as he looked up at Anders. I quickly threw my phone back in my purse and turned around to see the car behind us. It was a black Honda Accord, and since it was dark outside and the tents on the car behind us were super dark, I wasn't able to make out who was in the whip. What I didn't do, though, was leave myself any time to wonder. I quickly came up out the seatbelt, reached into the back seat, took out two Dracos and handed one to corporate while I kept the other. It ain't just that car. It's the one on the left of us too. That's two cars back. I thought I was tripping at first, but nah, they definitely trailing us, Anders casually said as he kept his left hand on the steering wheel. With his right hand, he went for the gun on his waist and pulled it out, placing it in his lap. I looked to my left, which was the side my husband was on, and I paid attention to the other Honda that was two cars back, just like Anders stated. That Honda was blue, and just like the black one, the tents were super dark, so I couldn't make out who was behind the wheel. I already knew what was about to happen. The black Honda behind us would eventually get on the right side of our car, which is where I was sitting, and they would start shooting. The blue Honda was going to zoom in front of the left side and attempt to catch us slipping. I could feel my adrenaline pumping, but it wasn't because of fear. It was because at that moment, I knew the lives of everyone inside that car was in danger, so I had the urge to protect us. It was now or nothing. Take them motherfuckers on a ride. I feel like having some fun. Corporate released. That comment just showed how much of a nut he was because he found the fun in this shit. Anders did exactly what Corporate told him to do and sped through the night air. He quickly jumped off the highway and got us onto a main road. Because Anders knew all the back streets to take, he took a route that was quite familiar to me. It was a back alleyway and it was pitch dark. Sometimes, depending on where I was coming from, I would take that route home because it was quicker. By that point, there was no question if the two Hondas were following us because they were on our ass. We'd made it to the back street and they did exactly what I said they would do, which was get on each side of us. You scared, P? Corporate asked. With the Draco in my hands, I rolled my eyes and rolled my window down, letting my actions answer his question. Oh, aye. That's what the fuck I thought. I thought my wife was scared. I was going to divorce your ass. I don't need no scary ass wife. My extra set of ears and my eyes behind my head, right? Ain't that what you tell my brothers? Be that for me, and I'ma always be that for you. was all he said. Just like my window had gone down, his and Anda's windows were down too. Less than 2 seconds later, gunshots rang out. I knew the proper way to shoot out of a car when I was being shot at. I couldn't have my whole body hanging out of the window because it would put me in danger of having one of those flying bullets hit me. So as I slouched down in my seat, I had the Draco out the window, letting my shit ring. All the while, bullets were flying in from the black Honda. Pow, 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 pow. It sounded like the 4th of July as we engaged in street battle. A few moments later, I heard a loud explosion, which was the result of the blue Honda on my husband's side crashing into a tree. The black Honda on my side still had shots coming, but I could tell it was only coming from one gun. Corporate moved his body to my side of the car and started sending shots. Once he did, all the shooting ceased. He moved my body out of the way and opened the door. I watched him walk over to the black Honda that had crashed into a tree as well. With the front and back windows rolled down, he shot inside, making sure every man was dead. Anders put the car in park and rushed over to the blue Honda. Corporate followed him, and they shot into that Honda as well. It was already sparking, and I could see that a fire was about to start. Their guns rang out for at least 15 seconds, and then they both rushed back to the car, and Anders took off. He ain't even give himself time to put his seatbelt on as he sped through the back alley, busted a right, and made his way to some apartments. There, he parked the car in the back, blending in with the rest of the cars. Like two niggas who were used to shit like this happening, my husband called the tow company that he used for missions like this to pick up the Escalade while Anders was on the phone with one of his drivers telling him where we were, and to bring another car. You good? Corporate asked me after he got off the phone. Yeah. Did you see how many men were in the car? I asked. It was four niggas in the black car and three of them in the blue one. All of them were gone. It ain't no secret who them niggas was, though. The driver in the blue car wasn't dead when we pulled up, gave his ass a headshot. I saw the BB tattoo on them niggas' heads. Seven more of them niggas down, and I don't know how many left to go, he stated. Fuck, man. Corporate went off and punched the front seat in... Wait, what? Punched the front seat in front of him? Okay, I guess that makes sense. I looked down at his arm and saw that he had blood oozing from it. Baby, you're bleeding, I screamed and grabbed his arm. He had been grazed by a bullet. Corporal was so high off adrenaline that he hadn't even noticed. The way I was freaking out, you would have thought I was the one who'd been popped and not the other way around. It's cool. We'll clean that shit up when we get home. You good? He asked me again. Instead of verbally answering, I just nodded. At that moment, all I could think about was that day in my old apartment with Corporate and him telling me about the roller coaster ride that it would be when he and I got official. I ain't think anything ever fully prepared me for the shit that I'd been through with this man. It wasn't that I was scared or anything, because I knew what I had to do to survive. I think the part that fucked me up the most was knowing I could have been slumped down, dead in the back seat of that car, just like the niggas in those Hondas were. That was the shit I thought about, and for that reason, I planned to go home and drink my wine straight from the bottle. I needed that. My nerves were shot, and I needed something in my system to calm me down. Hell, the way I felt, I just might spark up a fucking blunt. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, shit, they got my motherfucker back hurting. Oh, my God, today. All right, y'all, I got a feeling we about to end on one hell of a fucking cliffhanger with this shit. But that's okay. That's a good thing, because it is preparing us for what? Book two. Oh, I need some more grapefruit in my life, child. Ooh, wee. This ain't good. All right, let me get my next time stamp, child. All right, I set it out a little bit because I know I need to speak to some folks. All right, spoke to Shaniqua and So Jazzy and Marva. Hey, Chocolate Z, welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. All right, let me drink a little bit of water too. Hold on, y'all. Chapter 19, Kyle Strong. I held a bottle of Hennessy in my hands and poured that shit out on my brother's grave, leaving a good amount inside the bottle so I could take the rest of it to the head. The Strong family had their very own section at the cemetery. My granddad, Kamil, was buried next to his wife. And then there was my pops, Kaden, who was buried next to my mother, and Kato was right there too. The family was buried together like it should be. It was well after 2 a.m. and had just gotten there a few minutes ago. I'd been at home with a lot of shit on my mind that was keeping me from sleeping. Usually, when shit got like that, I'd take my ass out to the cemetery and talk to the people that I missed most. Before I left, I got on Instagram and started searching through profiles and shit on there. Yes, I was a 54-year-old man with Instagram. To look at me, you wouldn't even know I was 54, though. Are you 54 or 55, motherfucker? Oh, it's 54. My bad. I'm the blind bitch, not him. Somebody's 55, though, I thought. Or maybe that's just my ass. Anyway, stay out of my goddamn business. All right, to look at me, you wouldn't even know I was 54, though. Shit, social media is where I met a lot of the women I entertained, so I'd never get rid of my page, even though I didn't post often. While I was on social media, something told me to look on my son Kanye's profile. I didn't follow that nigga or nothing like that, but I knew he was popular on that shit, and he took that social media shit serious. His profile was verified, and he had over 2 million followers due to his popularity for doing hair and his fashion. I ain't gonna even lie. I found myself dropping tears looking at the gay-ass nigga who had come from my balls. Nigga had pictures and videos of himself on his page, dressed up like a whole woman with all that makeup and shit. As a father, I just felt let down. The reason it bothered me so much was that Kanye was my twin, and I expected that nigga to follow in my footsteps, yet he'd taken a completely different route. Well, nigga, you act like the damn man had a fucking choice. He didn't have a choice in that shit, sir. Yes, he has the choice on whether or not he lives out loud and proud, but he didn't have a, he was born with his attractions to who they are. Mind your motherfucking business, sir. Worry about what's on the tip end of your dick instead of worrying about what your son got going on. Stupid ass. Because I didn't agree with that nigga's lifestyle, he and I didn't have a good relationship. These days, I really only saw him when we had family gatherings or when I would pull up on Kyrie and he would be at his house. When that happened, most times it would end with us saying some slick shit to each other. A lot of people might view me as wrong because I was the father and I should love my kids no matter what, but I don't think people saw my point of view. I was hurting behind this shit too. Frustrated, I finally gave up on trying to sleep and decided to visit my big brother. Now, there I was at the cemetery getting drunk and airing out my grievances. Kato, man, what the fuck did you do, big bro? You were supposed to leave this legacy to me and Keanu. You left that shit to your son and Shadae, and I don't feel like they running this shit the way they supposed to be running it. There's a lot of shit going on right now with the family business, and I think we can all feel that shit is about to go left. You my brother, and I love you, but this wasn't the right move, I voiced aloud. Why it wasn't? A deep voice asked from behind me. I'm not gonna lie, that voice scared the shit out of me, so I instantly reached for my gun and pulled my shit out. It was Corporate standing out there dressed in all black, Nike sweatsuit with the hoodie pulled over his head. My gun was on him, but he casually had his hands in his pockets like he wasn't fazed in the least. I could kill this nigga and get away with it, but that would have been the most disrespectful shit I could do. There was no way I could kill my nephew right next to my granddad, my pops, and my brother's graves. I would have all of them tossing and turning, so I just put my gun up and placed my hands in my pockets too, glaring up at him. You following me? I ain't gotta follow you, nigga. I come out to this cemetery at least 3 times a week, and this is usually the time that I come. You doing something that's worth me following you? He asked, looking just like Kato. I can't even act like I didn't see why Kato gave Corporate the position to run this business, because he honestly was just a younger version of his father, but it was so hard for me to accept because I rightfully felt like that position was owed to me as well. Nah, nigga, I ain't got shit going on for you to be following me, I responded, and he nodded. I heard about the shootout that took place a couple of days ago, and I wanted to ask the nigga about it, but I ain't say nothing. I learned about the shooting from Kyrie because Corporate told him shit was getting sloppy with this business, and that was another thing I came out there to talk to my brother and my pops and my granddad about, but this nigga was out there now interrupting me and shit. I'm curious to know why Kato putting me and Shadae in charge wasn't the right move. You say that shit all the time, but you never really back it up with any solid hardcore facts, Corporate went on to say. That shit ain't personal, corporate. But at the end of the day, Kato could have given that shit to me and Keanu. We were next in line for the business. Let me ask you something, Unc. When Caden died, he had three sons that he could have passed the torch down to. It could have been my pops, you, or Keanu. He chose to pass that shit down to Kato. Why you not questioning the fact that your own fucking daddy ain't see you running this shit, which is why he gave it to Kato? Don't even sit there and say he gave it to Kato because he was older than you and Keanu, because age don't mean shit. Let me put you up on something, Unc. Every nigga isn't worthy of running a motherfucking empire. Every nigga can't sit at the head of the table giving orders and telling a bunch of motherfuckers what to do. You just happen to be that nigga who didn't fit the qualifications. You're bothered. That for years, Shadae has been able to successfully run shit with me, and there hasn't been a fuck up in sight. Yeah, shit been a little rocky lately, but everything that's been happening, we were forced to fucking finish shit that niggas started with us. Them BB niggas were plotting on us. I had one of their fucking niggas spying around my warehouse, so my wife had to put that nigga the fuck down. That's how motherfuckers who work for Strong handle their fucking business, he barked, walking close and getting in my face. His jaw was clenched and so was mine. If you don't like the way shit running over here, I told you before that it's plenty of doors you can use to exit this motherfucker. You bringing a negative aura to the family that's starting to rub people the wrong way, and I'm sick of this shit. It's one thing for us to be beefing with niggas outside this organization, but it becomes a different problem when we're constantly beefing with a nigga we work with, he stated. You got it, nephew. I'ma work on that, I said, and left it alone. What information you got on Shadae? He asked. His question caught me off guard. What you talking about? I asked. I know my mama, nigga. I think the only person Shadae ever really backed down to was Kato. That was the only nigga who could get Shadae to shut the fuck up. You came in the office the other day and Shadae ain't have shit to say. That shit been on my mind ever since. Is some shit that you would like to share with me? He asked again. I swallowed the lump in my throat as I looked him in his eyes. Nah, man, me and Shadae go at it so much that I'm sure the sight of me just rubs her the wrong way. What information could I possibly have on your mama, man? You tripping, I said. Corporate glared at me for a few seconds longer and then nodded. He walked over to the graves, looked at each one for a few moments, and then backed away. Unc, he called out after he walked a few feet down. I turned around to look at him. I don't believe you, but I'm gonna find out what it is, he coldly stated, and then he walked away, hands in his pockets, blending into the darkness. No lie, his words kind of gave a nigga chills. Corporate's actions again had just proven to me why Kato had put him in the position he did. That nigga was able to pick up on shit that would go over a lot of niggas' heads. I had Shadae shook for me pulling up on her the other night when I was drunk, and her actions around me were gonna expose our secret. No doubt about it, if Corporate ever found out that I'd fucked his mama and there was a possibility that Kody might belong to me, I knew he would kill me. Shit, the nigga had been looking for a reason to kill me for years, but he ain't really have one. After standing in the graveyard for a little longer, I eventually walked off and made it to my car. 5 minutes into my drive home, my phone rang. It was a phone call from Petey. I answered it through Bluetooth so the conversation could play through the speakers. What's good? I asked. Yo, what's the move, my nigga? You got some motion for me? Me and my niggas out here getting a little antsy, Petey responded. I sucked my teeth because ever since I ran into this nigga at the bar, he'd been hitting my phone up every other day wanting some motion, but I was still trying to put a plan together. Man, nigga, didn't I tell you to stop calling me every other fucking day like you my bitch? I have a plan in motion, but you gotta give me some fucking time, yo. Damn, chill the fuck out. I know y'all niggas hungry, but I got y'all, I barked. You been screaming that shit for a few weeks and nothing has changed. I feel like you on some bullshit right now. You have to let a nigga know something because me and my niggas thinking about switching to the other side, he barked. And what's the other side? Amiri coming home, and I already know that nigga gonna have motion. He down with BB, but at this point, I need money, and I'm willing to get that shit by any means. If you don't come up with something by the time that nigga gets home, I'm teaming up with them BB niggas. I know they'd be happy to have a nigga on their side, he threatened and hung up the phone. I sat at the red light trying to remember who Amiri was because I knew the name sounded familiar. That's when it hit me. He used to sell weight but got picked up on drug charges right at the peak of his career. He was a hustler, and I knew he would come home and make some shit shake. I could see him coming home and having a nice little operation because a lot of niggas fucked with him. thinking about that nigga. I also remember that pleasure used to fuck with that nigga. Miami is big, yet so small, so rumors get around fast. I remember being at Diamonds when she used to dance, and I caught the two of them together plenty of times. Just like how my brothers with pleasure, Amiri used to be sprung the fuck out over her ass, too. I sat back and laughed, knowing the way the shit was about to unfold once that nigga got home. On the other hand, it wasn't so funny because I ain't want to lose Petey and the rest of them niggas and have them work for Amiri. I had to come up with a fucking plan, and soon I had no choice but to try to get my own thing running because I saw that shit in Corporate's eyes tonight that he was getting sick of my shit and was about to let me go. I couldn't let him serve me my walking papers with nothing to fall back on. First things first, though, I needed to find a plug. Once I did that, hopefully Kyrie and Keanu would come over with me. We could run our own shit without having to take the backseat and take orders from a bitch and her son anymore. I felt like my son would probably come, but not so much Keanu. Keanu acted like he ain't care that he wasn't handed down the business, so he might stay where he's at, being stagnant, but that just ain't me. And that's the end of that chapter. Oh, Lord have mercy. This is crazy. All right. I don't even know what to say. I really don't. Because I feel like this is bad enough they fighting the niggas on the street, the BB niggas or whoever. But now they got, you know, it's the snakes on the inside of the camp. It's one thing, you know, when you step outside, you know, you got snakes in the grass, right? But when you walking in your own backyard and it's fucking snakes and them motherfuckers eating out of your garden, boy, hell no. That's knock a nigga in the dirt type shit. Chapter 20, Pleasure Strong. You got potential. You got potential. One of my favorite Summer Walker songs crooned through the speakers in the basement where I was in my spirit room, which was just a unique name that I came up with for the room where I kept my stripper pole. I would go in there just to dance and blow off some steam. From the age of 18 until I was 25, the pole had been where I could feel free, lay all my problems down, and just run away from a lot of the shit going on in my life. I've always known how to dance. I was the kid who would bust out in a dance no matter where the hell I was. I was flexible as hell, too. See, the reason I already knew how to do some stripper moves at 18 is that I used to spend a lot of time at Rika's house when we were in high school. Her mom used to have a stripper pole in her bedroom that she would use when her man came over. When Rika's mom wasn't home, we would take our fast asses in her bedroom and practice on her pole. So when we turned 18 and graduated from high school, we quickly landed jobs at our first club since we already knew how to work the pole. My talent only got better as I danced more and learned from other women around me. When I started, one of my favorite dancers to watch was Carmel. Y'all might know Carmel as Drika. My girl went from the pole to the palace. Drika used to dance for Sin City, and there wasn't a soul who could touch her when it came to her pole dancing skills. So I used to go to Sin City just to watch her and get inspiration. In the stripping business, a lot of big-time strippers didn't like to help other women out with moves and shit, so I was scared as hell to approach Drika for lessons, but she was so nice and humble. She agreed to work with Rika and me to improve our skills, and I will forever love her for that. She'd helped me out tremendously. That was my girl, even to this day, and we hit each other up every blue moon. When I moved in with Corporate, one of the main things that I asked him was if the empty room in the basement... Oh, shit! Why? Why you didn't call me from the steps? Jesus. Scare the fucking bejesus out of me. Hold on. I'm sorry, y'all. They done pushed this fucking thing back an hour, so it's cool. All right. Go ahead. All right, sorry, y'all. Child, listen. No, they just walk on fucking air. I swear. I promise you. I don't know what it is, but that's just what they do. All right. One of the main things that I asked him was if the empty room in the basement could be transitioned into a room for me where I could dance. Y'all know my husband rarely tells me no, so he jumped on it quick and had a whole team come over. I explained my vision, and they'd over-excelled on the job they did in there for me. It wasn't that I missed the strip club, but that peace had been a very important part of my life, so I wanted a room that would kind of mirror that. My pole was right in the middle of the room on a stage. In front of it was two sections with black leather couches, even though my husband was the only one who came in there and watched me dance. Off to the side, there was a bar which housed some of my favorite drinks. I also had those color temperature integrated LED lights in the ceiling, which I used with a remote. Right now, I had the color set to red. My pole was a special and had LED lighting as well, so I had the color on red there, too. Everything about that room was a vibe, and I was in a zone, doing a couple of warm-up spins around the pole, preparing myself for the real thing. I'd been so busy these days that I really hadn't had that much time to come in there and dance as much as I used to, but I still had it. Certain skills would never leave. Had a few niggas ride or die for me. Tell me, baby, will you slide for me? As Summer Walker's voice continued to beautifully sound off in the room, I climbed all the way up to the top of the pole, made sure I had my legs and my arms securely wrapped around it, held that position for a few seconds, and then I removed my legs. I reached my right hand down a little further while keeping my left hand higher. In seconds, I was able to flip my body, so I was hanging upside down, moving my legs to the music. Then I opened them all the way into a straddle, closed my legs back, and skillfully slid down the pole. I was in such a zone, letting the music and my dancing take me away that I hadn't even noticed I had company. My husband was standing in the room looking at me with appreciation on his face. I was shocked to see him because over an hour ago when I showered and came down, he'd been on the phone with his brothers talking business. I just knew he'd be upstairs for a while, but he'd surprised me with his presence, so now I really had to put on one hell of a show. Although he was standing a good distance away from me, I could smell the nice, inviting scent of the soap he'd used in the shower. He wore a pair of gray sweats, and the dick print should have been against the fucking law. His shirt was off, so his nice, toned upper body was on full display, and he had on a pair of Dior slides. His do-rag was on his head, and the same way I was lusting over him, he was lusting over me. Do your thing, baby. I just came to be entertained. I ain't gonna fuck with you, he stated, but I knew he was lying. I watched him go over to the bar, pour himself some Hennessy and one of the cognac glasses, and then he came over to the sofa and took a seat right in front. He sipped from his drink and quickly put the glass down. His legs were spread as he sat with his arms folded, watching me. I went back to the pole, put my left hand on it, and then I seductively walked around it, lustfully moving my hips to the music. I stopped right in front of the pole and faced it, giving my husband my back. Grabbing the bottom of the pole with my left hand, I kept my right hand at the top. Using all the strength from my upper body, I flipped myself to hang upside down again. Then I twirled around the pole and just kept spinning and spinning until I eventually stopped and landed gracefully on my feet. I knew Corporate loved pussy shots, so with my back facing him again, I bent over, giving him a nice view of me from the back as I seductively danced to the music. There was a confidence that I carried when I was in front of the pole because I knew I looked damn good. I stood before Corporate in a silver two-piece set made of crystals, the top tied in the back and my nipples were exposed. The bottoms were a thong, so he had the perfect view of my ass and he could see my pussy lips playing peekaboo from the back. I wore long, clear heels that had me standing up way taller than I really was, and my skin was nice and oiled up. My hair was casually hanging, and there wasn't a lick of makeup on me, yet I felt my prettiest when my face was bare of any enhancements. The song had switched, and now Summer Walker, SZA, and Cardi B's song No Love, the extended version, played. I was a huge Summer Walker fan, so while the playlist had a lot of R&B, many of the songs were hers, and it was on shuffle. But if I had your back, all I'd want to do is fuck. Get drunk, take drugs, fuck love, all I want to do is fuck. As the song played, I climbed to the top of the pole. Once I was at the top, I held on with both hands and started walking in the air, looking like I was floating. I went around twice and then wrapped my body around the pole and flipped myself again, so I was hanging upside down with only my legs wrapped around the pole. I just hung for about 5 seconds until I came back up doing tricks on my way down. I looked behind me at my husband, and he had that same look of satisfaction on his beautiful face. Standing in front of the pole with my eyes on him, I started swaying my hips to the music again. I eventually dropped, going all the way down and opening my legs, giving him a shot of the pussy, this time from the front. The look in his eyes told me that he was thoroughly turned on by what I was doing, and I could see his dick was hardening in his sweats. He ain't even tried to put his hand in his lap or anything to hide it. My man was gonna let that dick rock up and try not to hide the fact that I had him turned on. Since I was already bent over, I just dropped to my knees and crawled off the stage. Once I reached him, I kneeled with my arms on his lap. He licked his lips as he looked down at me. I stood and turned my body around so my back was facing him. Then I backed up his way, going as close to him as I could before I bent over and held my ankles, this time letting him get the pussy shot closer up. I already knew Corporate wouldn't be able to control himself, so I wasn't even shocked when the nigga reached up, pulled my thong to the side, and swiped his index finger from my clit to my slit. When he pulled it out just that quick, his finger was coated in my silky juices. Like the nasty nigga he was, he licked it clean and then placed one of his arms on the arm of the couch and the other on the table, basically letting me know he was gonna let me do my thing and not fuck with me anymore. Still bent over, I twerked my right ass cheek and my left, and then I did both. After doing that, I stood halfway up and slammed all that ass in his lap, right on his rock-hard dick. Then I started giving him a lap dance, grinding all over that dick as my body moved to the music. My eyes were closed, and I was in my own little world. I'm not gonna lie, sharing that moment with my husband had me thinking about our earlier days. I remember the first night Corporate let me give him a dance at the club. Of course, he didn't admit it that night, but I knew he fell in love with me then. I danced my ass off, doing shit for him that I'd never done to any other nigga. Corporate was such a mean-ass nigga who gave off nonchalant vibes, so I felt compelled to impress him, and that's exactly what I did. My legs were on the floor as I ground in his lap. He removed his left hand from the table and brought it up, placing it on my flat stomach. His head leaned into the crook of my neck, tickling me with his beard, and he placed a long, sweet kiss on my neck that had me releasing an involuntary moan. That same hand that was on my flat stomach, it lowered, going right to my pussy. He started rubbing my clit through the fabric of my thong. I let that go on for about 5 seconds before I removed his hand, flipped myself in his lap, put my feet on each side of him, and was back to grinding again. My hands wrapped around his neck as I moved my body up and down, side to side, twerking like I had his dick inside me, and I was putting on one of my best shows. I could tell that I was fucking with this nigga's head by doing all of that grinding and shit on him. I could feel his dick hardening. Yet every time he tried to touch me, I removed his hand. Eventually, I leaned my body back, going all the way down to the point that I was holding onto his ankles. When I did that, my pussy was right in his face, a fresh waxed pussy that smelled amazing. Corporate reached down and pulled my thong to the side again. He observed my pussy like it was his first time seeing it. The nigga was in love. I saw it in his eyes and felt it in his dick. I was wet myself. The ambiance in the room mixed with me being turned on by my fine-ass husband, who I knew was getting ready to lay that dick down, had me soaked. But I wanted to finish performing for him. I tried to sit up, but Corporate placed his other hand on my stomach in an attempt to keep me lying back. "Corporate, let me finish. Daddy, I was just getting started," I whined, looking up at him. "Baby, your pussy right in my face. I'm trying to eat." "I can't eat?" he asked. His slick ass leaned his head down, and the way he started tongue-kissing my pussy had me screaming. Unable to stand the heat, I tried to push his head out of the way. He spit on it, kissed my clit, and then leaned back in his seat, pulling me up by my arm. Now I was back to sitting in his lap and looking in his eyes as he had my pussy juices on his lips. I cuffed his beard, leaned my head in, and we started kissing. The whole time we kissed, Corporate had his hands glued to my ass, running up and down. We were literally making love to each other with just our tongues. It wasn't long before Corporate stood with me in his arms and placed me on the table. "P, I'm trying to be respectful, but you a nigga. My wife just put on a performance of a lifetime for Daddy, so let me thank you. You just showed out, so let me show out next," he voiced. whatever performance I had left in me, I knew it wouldn't happen because corporate was adamant about eating my pussy. And the way I felt in that moment, I was gonna let him. There was a black cloth on the table and I watched him grab it and hold it in his hands. Then he lifted my legs and put them on the table so they were on either side of me. He sat back down on the sofa and faced me as he laid the cloth out like my pussy was dinner, because he knew my juices were gonna spit. The cloth was just there to prevent me from making a sloppy mess on the table. Corporate didn't give a damn about the thong I was wearing because he quickly ripped it, tossed it to the floor, and placed his hands on my knees. Then he went in with just his head and started eating. Oh, Corporate, what the fuck? I cried, feeling his thick tongue licking all around my clit and making circles. He then grabbed my clit with just his lips and softly started tugging on it. I ain't think anyone understood how good that shit felt. His fingers weren't in me or anything. This was just straight tongue action, pussy eating skills, and he was gonna drive me fucking crazy. My head dropped and I looked down at him. He was such a fucking menace that as he ate from my treasure, he stared me dead in my eyes. Fuck, I'm a cum, I screamed and reached down to push his head out of the way once I finished releasing because my clit was extra sensitive, but he just kept eating me. I couldn't back down to corporate, so once it was back to feeling good, I placed my hand on the back of his head and started fucking his face with my pussy. I cried out, whined, moaned, and screamed because it felt so fucking good. Shit, I'm a squirt, baby, it's coming. I cried again, and my legs started shaking. Corporate still had his hands on my knees, and this time, when I tried to run my ass away from his tongue, he let me get my moment to catch my breath as he came out of his slides, sweats, and briefs. All the while, his eyes were on me, looking like he was about to handle me and my pussy. Shit, after what we'd gone through earlier in the week, we deserved this moment to fuck each other's brains out. I'm not gonna lie, I was still shaken up from that shootout, and Corporate was pissed that it had happened. He kept saying he hated that I had to be with him when that shit went down. Ultimately, it is what it is, and we can't take it back. I was just happy to still be alive, but the sad part was that this was only the beginning. We had just killed more men from the BB crew, so there would only be more bloodshed. Where you want it? I'm trying to fuck you right here on this table, Corporate said, with that thick, long dick in his hands, just waiting for me to tell him where I wanted it. Fuck me on the table then, baby. It's your world, I reminded him. Nah, it's actually your world. I'm just living in it, he let me know before grabbing my leg and pulling me closer to the edge. Once both of my legs were wide open for him, he reached back and unsnapped my top, letting it fall. Now I was naked before him, hands behind me, palms on the table, as I waited to feel that dick. Corporate's dick was so heavy as he placed it right at the base of my pussy and rubbed the head up and down, using his pre-cum to mix in with my juices that were steadily seeping out. Then he slipped inside me, causing my head to drop back, my eyes to roll, and I was back to moaning. I'm behind you or in front of you? His bedroom voice was on as he slammed that dick repeatedly in and out of me. In front, Daddy, I moaned. Then lift your head and look at me. You missing everything that's happening in front of you. Look what your pussy got the power to make me do. P, you got my tongue hanging out my mouth like a fucking dog. Your pussy doing that. Your pussy got me biting my lip and my eyes rolling. You don't want to see that shit? You ain't trying to see the power that pussy got? I'm damn near on the verge of tears. This pussy so good. Show a nigga a trick or something. What kind of skills you know how to do with that pussy? Corporate's sexy voice asked. The way he was talking to me was getting me wetter. By then, I had my head leaned up and I was looking into his eyes, enjoying the fuck faces that my husband was making and getting so turned on by how he was biting his lip. I met him thrust for thrust and gripped his dick with my pussy muscles. That drew a moan from him. Damn, baby. Is it like that? Corporate asked, leaning his head in to kiss me on my neck. He kissed both my nipples and looked me in my eyes again. I was so busy nonstop moaning and yelling that I couldn't even tell him that I was coming. I just wet his entire dick up without a warning or anything. My legs were shaking so hard and I was breathing loud as hell. I think I got myself into some shit that would be hard to get out of. He showed out too much with the way he ate my pussy, making me come back to back too fast. And that first round of sex felt like the finale. Yet this nigga hadn't even gotten his yet. Daddy, you gotta give me 5 minutes. I feel like I'ma die. Is dick not worth dying for? He asked, not paying my weak ass request any mind as he threw my ass on the couch, putting me on all fours. I mentally prepared myself for this one. This position was one of our favorites, and it was where we both showed off. The music was still playing, but now the song has switched to Brent Faiyaz's Rehab, Winter in Paris. That song came on at the right time because it was such a vibe for us to fuck so nasty to. In the streets, they be thinking you a lady, but at home, you a motherfucking porn star. If you ain't nasty, don't at me. I reached back and glided his dick up and down my pussy before I stuck it inside. Corporate never even gave a bitch the chance to run because he had his hand firmly on my waist, not letting me go anywhere. Oh, I bitched up trying to scoot. I felt straight pressure on my pussy, so I was itching to go further up on the couch. Corporate reached up and wrapped his hand around my throat. Then he pulled my ass up, dick still inside me, fucking me deep and slow. By that point, I was dropping tears. It was a good hurt, and my emotions were all over the place. You running, or you was just trying to get comfortable? His deep voice crooned in my ear because his lips were right next to it. Just getting comfortable. Shit, I lied, knowing damn well I was running. Oh, all right, tell a nigga something then. I'm in there good enough, he asked. His ass was in there too fucking good, and he knew it. You are. Can I come? I asked. I was coming back to back with no shame. Do your big one. That's why he in there. Wet him up, baby, Corporate coached me. His grip around my throat tightened a bit, and I released an orgasm that was way bigger than the first one. As I breathed through the aftermath of my orgasm, I turned my head to look at him, and the kissing started back up. We paused so I could spit in his mouth. He gladly accepted it, then slipped me his tongue, which I sucked on, and then he lowered the front half of my body onto the couch while my ass was tooted up in the air, and then he was back to fucking me from the back. This time we fucked quietly. Well, there was no talking going on, just moans and grunts. I was throwing that ass back on Corporate, and his hands were on my small waist. He had his eyes closed as he bit his lip, enjoying this shit. I knew he was about to nut, and that's why I started showing off, doing all kinds of tricks with my ass, bouncing it, shaking it, but still keeping that dick inside me. We both came at the same time. Corporate fucked me in that room like he was fucking me off a sex pill. I was crying because Daddy wasn't showing me any mercy. What started out as me just dancing for him turned into our own mini porn. I swear we fucked for an hour straight. When we were done, I couldn't even feel my legs. I was slumped over on the floor when he finished with me, so he had to carry me out of the room, take me up the stairs, and put me in bed. I felt when he came over with the warm washcloth to wipe me off, but eventually I just dozed off. This was definitely me getting fucked to sleep because I ain't even had the energy to tell him how good the sex was. I was out. And that's the end of that chapter. Ooh, Lord, shit, I'm tired. Reading that shit got my ankles swollen. Ooh, Lord, hamburger. Okay, Corporate, I see you, nigga. Ooh, wee. All right, let me get my next timestamp. All right, y'all gonna have to give me at least a good minute. Because I need to open up another bottle of water, child, and get some water in my mouth. Okie dokie. Oh, child, I thought my little time was up. Because you know a minute go by real quick, child. Oh, Lord. Not yet, though. Not yet. Okay. Chapter 21, Corporate Strong. This nigga, man, somebody pull a phone out and take a picture of this shit. Matter of fact, let me get Kennedy on the motherfucking phone so she can see this shit. Let me find out you miss selling dope, I excitedly said as I slapped it up three times with my nigga Mustafa. He had hit me earlier in the day and said he had a light schedule and he just wanted to pull up on me to chop it up for a bit. Since I'd been so busy with work and shit, I hadn't been able to see my guy in a while, so you know I told bro to pull up. Mustafa and I shared the same last name, Strong, but I swear we ain't related. Growing up, he and I used to talk so much shit to each other. I would say that his family stole our last name and he would talk shit back, accusing my family of stealing his. Sorry, I had to sneeze, child. Ooh, Lord. Over the years, I'd met a lot of people with a Strong last name, but it didn't make us blood. Although Mustafa wasn't blood, it felt like he was because this was my fucking brother right here. He used to run his own drug empire. See, Mustafa was a nigga who demanded a lot of power and respect, just as I did. He was a damn good leader, so there was no way in hell he could ever be the kind of nigga to work for me. It never came to that. He ran his own shit, and I ran mine. Mustafa retired from the drug game years ago, though. Them niggas shot and killed his baby girl, Joy, and that fucked the whole city up for real. That was his only daughter at the time, and that man was in love with Joy. I still get chills when I think about Joy's funeral and hearing Kennedy, Mustafa's wife, screaming in that church as she had to look down at her baby girl in a casket. That shit fucked up their marriage, too. Kennedy couldn't cope with that shit, so she ended up getting strung out on drugs and was in the streets, doped out for years. Their shit came together in the end, though. Kennedy got cleaned up. She and Mustafa got back together, and they were raising their beautiful kids. He was just staying out the way, but we would pull up on each other every so often. Real shit, though. Knowing what Kennedy and Mustafa had to go through after losing Joy was one of the main reasons I ain't want kids. This was a dirty-ass game that I was in. Shit, look how I was beefing with those BB niggas. If I had a child right now, the first thing they would do to hurt me was to snatch up my kid and kill them. I ain't willing to go through that. Hold on, y'all. All right, y'all, sorry about that. I was standing there now looking at a nigga with his beautiful daughter's face tattooed on the inner part of his arm in memory of her. So nah, I gotta honestly say that having kids really scared the fuck out of me. Man, please don't call that crazy ass woman. I told her I was pulling up on you and she told me not to get no fucking ideas. In her exact words, she said, dap them niggas up and come back home to your family. A slick-ass mouth had to remind me that I wasn't a street nigga no more, Mustafa said. I laughed at that shit, already knowing that Kennedy was a firecracker. Little as hell, but she talked shit like a motherfucker. I'd seen her ass in action on plenty of occasions. Tell sis I don't want no smoke. What's up with you, though? You been good? I asked. Yeah, man, out here making this legitimate corporate money and spoiling the fuck out of my wife and my kids. Nothing too crazy. Turn the air down and put a little warmth to this coffee before you leave. All right. Where P at? I ran into her a few weeks ago at the mall. That's my girl with her crazy ass, he said. She's headed here now. We about to have a meeting soon. You don't want to miss this shit, I asked. He laughed while shaking his head. I'm gonna be real with you, Kay. I can't miss something that robbed me of the chance to see my baby girl grow up. Kennedy and my mama always used to preach to me, telling me how this game didn't love me. Of course, I knew where they were coming from with that, but you know a nigga wasn't trying to hear that shit. The streets made me feel what that shit meant, though. when I had to stand in a fucking morgue and look down at my baby with a dime-sized bullet hole in the middle of her head and other shots to her chest. I don't miss it. The streets changed me in a way that I'll never fully heal from, you know? Joy's birthday is coming up in a few more weeks. You know what that means for me, nigga. I'ma have to pick my wife up and hold her while she's crying and sad that another year went by without our baby, he said. He said some real shit to me, causing me to nod my head, fully agreeing with where he was coming from. I feel you, man. They took something from you that you'll never get back. Man, that's my fear. It ain't much that scares me, but because I don't have any kids, my wife is like that one thing in my life that'll bring a nigga down to my fucking knees. We in some deep shit right now. Got enemies popping out left and right. Thank you. And it's pleasure that I'm scared for, even though that woman can defend the fuck out of herself. We got in a shootout the other day, and she was right there in the car, busting her gun with me. I can't stop thinking about that shit, I vented. How many more years you feel you got left in the game? He asked. I ain't ready yet, I responded. I'ma say some real shit to you. If I hadn't lost Joy, I would have probably still be hustling too. I wasn't ready to walk away from it before Joy was killed, but to appease Kennedy, I kept telling her to give me a couple more years, knowing I was willing to grow old in that shit. I ain't here to preach to you, nigga, because I was once in your shoes, but just remember, it's rarely any growing old in this game that we so desperately love. If we don't die, we lose loved ones. We get put in prisons for the rest of our lives. Those are our two possible fates. Remember that, he preached. I nodded in agreement, and then I shook it up with him. We stood out there and talked for about 15 minutes before I walked him through the building. Since you couldn't be from Miami and not know who Mustafa was, they treated my nigga like a legend as he made his way through the building. He ended up leaving about 5 minutes before the meeting started and right before Pleasure arrived. She had been on the other side handling shit for me at the Enterprise, so she made it just in time for the meeting. Yeah, nigga, because your ass not about to have me standing outside them fucking doors again. My shit-talking ass wife shot, standing in front of me in a denim long pants romper that fit tight around her body. She had on clear heels and her shoulder-length jet black bob. Damn, pull the dick out your mouth. All right, was styled to perfection. She wore light makeup, and seeing her in front of me, I swear all I could think about was that good-ass fucking we did last night. Chef's fucking kiss. That pussy was so good last night that I wouldn't have even let her stand outside of the door if she walked in that bitch a whole hour late. I'm high off pussy, baby. You could have walked in this motherfucker anytime you wanted, I said, with my large hand on her ass, squeezing one of her cheeks. She laughed and kissed me on my lips, letting me know how much she loved me, and I did the same in return. After our moment, Pleasure took her seat at the long rectangular table where everyone was waiting for me to start. Shadae was standing next to me, and the second she got ready to say something, we heard a bunch of commotion outside the meeting room doors. I thought I recognized the voice, but I wasn't too sure who it was. It sounded like a voice that I hadn't heard in years. I don't give a fuck about no meeting, nigga. Open this motherfucking door, the loud squeaking voice barked. I heard someone tug the door handle and I froze in place, remembering where I knew that voice from. It belonged to Xavier, a bitch I hadn't seen in well over 17 years. The last time I fucked that bitch, I was 22 years old. I was a year into running the Strong organization with Shadae. You couldn't tell a nigga shit. I was still humble, as I ever been, but during that time in my life, I went on a fucking spree. I was fucking more bitches than I was used to. I wasn't reckless with my shit or anything like that, but I was taking more bitches down than I normally did. Xavier was a bitch I went to high school with. Like I mentioned before, she used to give me firehead in the bathroom back when we were in school. Xavier had always been a fine bitch, but she was just too fucking loud. She stayed on that bullshit, and that's why I never really got serious with her. After high school, we fucked around, but it was just something we did every blue moon. The last night I fucked her, I went in raw, making her the first woman I ever had unprotected sex with, and my wife the second. If I'm not mistaken, I pulled out that night, so I was curious as to why her ass was down there making all this fucking noise. At least I hoped I did, because my pullout game wasn't the strongest, but damn, I still wanted to have faith and say that I did. Dub, my security, was outside refusing to let her in, but our eyes met, and he was looking at me, trying to figure out what I wanted him to do. I gave him the head nod, letting him know that it was cool to let her in, because Xavier's ass wasn't a threat to anyone there. The bitch was just gonna scream and talk everyone to death. A piece of me was curious to know why her black ass had popped up on me, and how the fuck did she even get inside the fucking building? Xavier didn't look like she'd aged at all. We were the same age, but she still held a youthfulness to her face. She had chocolate skin, just like my wife, and tall, with a slim frame, like she could be a model. She had a long-ass weave that went all the way down to her ass, and she rocked a cream-colored maxi dress that fit her tight as hell with a pair of furry slides on her feet. She looked good, but in her face, I could see signs of stress, and I wondered what the fuck that had to do with me. "Boy, come on," Xavier screamed to someone. I was thoroughly confused, because who the fuck was she calling? The confusion was short-lived, because in walked a nigga who looked like he came right out of my balls. She grabbed his ass up by the front of his shirt, even though he was much taller than her. He stood there with an angry scowl on his face, the angry, strong scowl that only niggas who shared blood with me knew how to do. My forehead started sweating as I stared at a nigga who was really my twin, just a younger version. He had a head full of dreads and they were long, hanging loosely down his back. He wore an Atlanta Falcons jersey with a pair of black jeans that sagged off his ass. Red, black, and white dunks were on his feet with a big-ass chain around his neck that had a big pendant which said, "Colony," spelled with a fucking K, y'all, because what else would a gutter rat ass bitch do besides name her out of wedlock ass baby with a letter that's oh my god. The same letter that his pappy's name starts with. Man, bean this fuckhole and get a DNA test for this child. "What the fuck you got going on, yo?" I asked Xavier, scared out of my fucking mind, but trying to play that shit cool. She looked at me, sucked her teeth, and rolled her eyes hard as fuck. "Look, corporate, I thought I could run off and raise this boy on my own, but I can't. His ass wants to be in the streets, and when I get that phone call saying that my son has been murdered or he's going to prison, I would rather not be so attached. So I'm leaving his ass here in Miami with you. It's your turn. I can't do this shit anymore. I raised him on my own for 17 years. You do it. Colony, meet your father. Corporate. Corporate, meet your 17-year-old son who swears he's a grown-ass fucking man. Colony Strong. I'm done." Her voice cracked. She walked over to him, and a lone tear fell from her eye as she kissed him on his forehead. Then she hauled ass out of the room. My eyes looked over at my wife, and her eyes were watery. The second she blinked, tears fell. Growing up, people used to call me a preacher because they swore I always had room to preach to someone. But I just had good sense. I was a man of many wise words, but this time, I ain't know what the fuck to say. I took a seat in the chair behind me and put my hand on my forehead as I looked at a nigga with golds in his mouth, dreads in his hair, and now that I paid more attention, this little nigga even had tattoos on his hand. That same woman that I talked about fucking without a condom had bore a kid for me, and I ain't even know, a kid who looked exactly like me. I couldn't even look at my wife because it broke my heart to know that I'd just broken hers. Fuck, man! To be continued.
Welp.
That's it, y'all. That's it. All right. So, I don't know. Hold on, y'all. Let me get the synopsis for the next book. All right. I didn't ask you to do that. I asked you to fucking give me the fucking synopsis, weirdo. There you go. All right. So that was the end of that book. Did I miss anybody? Child, I swear, I think... One second, y'all. Okay. All right. Hey, Lexi, welcome. Thank you for being here. Hey, Shakara, welcome, welcome. Tell my bestie, I said, hey, girl, hey. She said, Lord, this is a mess. Why would she wait until now to let him know that he has a kid? And how is she okay with just dropping Shorty off? You know, and like, you don't know if he gonna accept the boy or not. But I mean, I guess he ain't had no choice because he looked just like the nigga, but still. I mean, damn, yo, that's a lot. But anyway, child, let me read y'all the synopsis to this book. It says, the gang is back with more drama than before. One of the biggest jaw droppers from part one was Corporate finding out about his 17-year-old son. Corporate has always been a stand-up guy, never the one to run away from his responsibilities. So he has every intention of stepping up to raise his son. Pleasure is well aware that Colony was conceived way before she was in the picture, but it still hurts to know that another woman gave her husband something that she hasn't yet. This will definitely test their marriage and shake the table so much. Part two of this series will reveal more secrets as family bonds and friendships are tested. The Strong family is facing so much adversity with new enemies popping up every day, it seems. At this point, their biggest challenge is trying to stay alive. 284 pages, which means probably 6 to 8 weeks to read. No, I'm just playing. Oh, okay. She at work right now. Well, you tell her. I said, hey, Tracy Four. Hey, girl. Hey. All right. So, yeah, y'all. That's it, child. That's it. That's all. So, start the new book tomorrow. Yep. So that's it, y'all. I'm guessing that something else is gonna happen because, like I said, it's a part three, child. It's a part three, child. So yeah, I don't know what that's gonna turn into, honey. But all I can say is y'all better get ready, honey, because it is what it is. So yeah, we'll start this one tomorrow, people. And I thank y'all for listening to me read out loud. It's always a good time over here when I decide to open up the speakeasy just a little bit. So y'all go forth and enjoy the rest of your day. Thank you, Love Jones, for being such a wonderful moderator. I truly, truly appreciate all of your hard work, little sis. Thank each and every one of y'all, because listen, child. I be so worried about y'all, but I don't... Girl, how did I speak to you, wifey? Child, listen. I think I did. I think I spoke to you. I don't know if I did or not. You didn't say nothing, so I'm assuming that I got to you, child. But hey, girl, hey. And and now it's time to go. All right, yeah, you lucky I was looking that way. Otherwise, you'd have scared me again. All right, y'all. So I love y'all. Y'all enjoy the rest of this good day. And if you do nothing else, please salute your spirit and protect your peace. Until next time, bye, y'all. She said, nope, you didn't speak to me, bitch. Hey, wifey, crazy tail self. Hey, girl, hey. All right, child. I don't know why you didn't get your notifications. I'm sorry about that. And I'm sorry I didn't see you. But hey, girl, hey. All right. Bye, y'all.